Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the third meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting remotely this week. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item five in private. Item five is consideration of today's evidence. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Item five will be taken in private. Our next agenda item is the consideration of a statutory instrument, the Deposit and Return Scheme for Scotland, Amendment Regulations 2022. And I welcome Lorna Slater, MSP, Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. The Minister is also joined by officials online, and I also welcome Maurice Golden, MSP, who is joining us for consideration of this instrument. Thank you all for joining this meeting. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. And following this evidence session, the committee will be invited to consider a motion to approve the instrument. And before I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement, let me highlight that we are very tight for timing this morning, so can we please have concise questions, answers and contributions. Minister, I will hand over to you for a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. In December, when I announced in Parliament the new implementation timetable for Scotland's deposit return scheme, I remarked that I was looking forward to engaging with members as we move into the scrutiny process, and I welcome the opportunity to do so today. The draft regulations before you provide a date of the 16th of August 2023 for full implementation of the deposit return scheme. As you know, an independent review commissioned as a result of the pandemic and uncertainties caused by Brexit concluded that the July 2022 implementation date was not achievable. We have engaged with industry, stakeholders and partner organisations to agree a project plan that will deliver a successful scheme by August 2023, while still retaining the original collection targets of 80% in 2024 and 90% in 2025. I have already announced the milestones in 2022 and 2023 that we will use to monitor progress on delivery. These include signing of key contracts by Circularity Scotland Limited, the scheme administrator, the construction of counting and sorting centres, the rollout of return infrastructure by retailers, and the launch of a return scheme in Orkney so that we can ensure our DRS works well in rural areas, which often have different needs compared to more populated parts of the country. As well as amending the implementation date, we are also taking this opportunity to make several smaller amendments to the regulations to support successful delivery and operation of DRS. Firstly, to provide additional reassurance to retailers through a distance sale who must offer a take-back service. This obligation is vital to the accessibility of the scheme and will remain. However, distance retailers can now refuse to accept a return of a disproportionately large number of containers in a single transaction. For products filled and sealed in a retail or hospitality setting, such as the kind of can known as a crowler, the person filling and sealing them, for example, the pub, will be the producer and will bear responsibility for their collection. Businesses that qualify as producers only because they sell crowlers will be exempt from the annual fee to register with SEPA, and this fee has been raised slightly from £360 to £365 to cover the cost of regulating these extra producers. The new regulations also make a small number of amendments to prevent fraud and to support SEPA effectively to enforce compliance. Thank you for your time. I truly believe that these proposed changes will help ensure that Scotland will have one of the most effective deposit return schemes in the world, and I look forward to working with you to make it a success.
Thank you very much, Minister. We will now move on to questions, and the first question will come from Liam Kerr to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. As requested, I'll cut to the chase, Minister. How much is the setting up the scheme going to cost, and will local authorities be compensated for potential revenue and job losses that some have theorised are going to happen?
In line with the principle of producer responsibility, the drinks producers will pay for the costs of setting up and operating the scheme. Our estimates of the cost of operating the scheme are set out in the publications such as the full business case addendum. The FBC addendum estimates the expenditure of £92.9 million per year for Circularity Scotland in a steady state. So you can see these costs are not being borne by local authorities, they are being borne by industry in the principle of polluter pays.
I'm not sure that answers my question, Minister, because there will obviously be a scheme cost to set it up to the public purse. Perhaps you can come back on that if you're aware of such costs and if it's been sorted out. But secondly, has the government strategised any scheme to allow smaller businesses to attract and retain customers in a similar manner to the big supermarkets, who presumably can incentivise customers through their loyalty schemes?
I'm not aware of any such schemes. My officials may have some more information on that.
Yeah, thanks, Minister. Not as such. I suppose we would agree with the member that there is a good opportunity here for small businesses to boost their boost their footfall by operating a return point. That's something we think should be an advantage for small businesses. There are steps that we've taken to make it easier for retailers to operate return points, such as creating an exemption from non-domestic rates for reverse vending machines, creating an exemption from planning permissions subject to certain conditions for reverse vending machines, and so forth. So there are steps we've taken to make it easier for them to operate a return point, if that answers the question.
Up to a point. Okay, one final question, Minister. Other jurisdictions, as you'll be well aware, are trialling a digital DRS system, which certainly on the research I've done would be cheaper, it would have a lower carbon footprint, and it would be, I think, easier for people to get involved with. Now, that begs a question. Has the Scottish Government conducted, or will it conduct, a business case and a feasibility study around a digital DRS? And will businesses who set up for your DRS scheme be compensated, and if so, by whom, for what would presumably be an obsolete outlay if a digital DRS is ultimately introduced in Scotland?
So the digital DRS is a really interesting technology, Circularity Scotland, and we've looked into it. It's not quite mature enough yet to be implemented on the timescale of this scheme, but we are aware of it, and Circularity Scotland are intending for example, the reverse vending machines that they would be advising businesses to install to be compatible with future digital schemes, so that there shouldn't be any problem with moving to such a thing in the future. It is an exciting technology, and when it is, you know, when it is mature and we can look at implementing it, I'm sure that will be the case.
Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Liam. Next up, Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So August 23 date, I think the Gateway review last summer did identify some risks with even going for that date. So I'm just wondering, Minister, what kind of work has been done to look at those risks? How are you mitigating some of those risks? I mean, everybody wants a deposit return scheme as quickly as possible, but clearly it needs to be up and running with the full confidence of retailers and the public. So can you identify what those remaining risks are around the August date and how those are being considered?
Thank you very much for the question. Despite the pressures over the last year, Circularity Scotland has taken some really important steps after being established in March of 2021. So they've established themselves as a limited company. They've secured the approval as a scheme administrator. They are currently securing startup funding and appointing key staff. So I've been meeting with them monthly and will continue to do so throughout the implementation to ensure that they are on track. And we've agreed some milestones. We expect to see significant progress in the coming months, including signed contracts with partners to deliver their logistics, operations and IT systems. We expect that by March of 2022. We expect a launch of a public awareness campaign in August 2022 so that businesses know they need to sign up for the scheme and for the public can know that it's coming. And we're going to be beginning to build counting and sorting centres also in August of 2022. So I am confident that we have milestones and robust governance and oversight to make sure that this will happen. And it will be done in a transparent way. We'll be showing pictures to the public of the sorting centres being built, and people can start to learn about the scheme.
Yeah, the transparency would be very welcome, I think, because the previous committee asked for milestones way back in 2019. I don't think we got that. So the fact we've got that now is good. Can I ask just one more final question, Convener? And it's about you know, what would happen today if, as a committee, we decide to not vote through this SI? What would be the implications for that, Minister?
So the independent gateway review, as you know, concluded that it was not possible to meet the original date of July 2022. So that would then put the producers, 35,000 producers and retailers, in the position of not being able to have the time to comply with the regulation. So we want this scheme to be a success, and that means allowing the scheme administrator and business time to implement that properly. And that involves, we've got to get IT systems set up, we've got to build these sorting centres, we've got to work out all the logistics, particularly around online take-back. So these things do take time. Unfortunately, Brexit and the pandemic did lead to getting started a bit later than we all could have hoped with the scheme. But now that we've got a plan and we've got some milestones, we've got a scheme administrator, we're going to be full steam ahead.
Okay, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Next up, Natalie Dawn, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. My first question has actually just been answered, so I'll move on. I have two further questions. One of the things that makes Scotland's DRS scheme so ambitious compared to other countries is the inclusion of glass. Now, this has been criticised by some, and there are some concerns that if it leads to more glass being crushed, then it might mean less glass recyclate available for the industry. So I'm just wondering if the Minister can guarantee that this won't happen.
Absolutely. The deposit return scheme will significantly increase the quantity and quality of glass recyclate, creating an aggregated and high quality feedstock for reprocessing. I understand that Circularity Scotland proposes that the glass be collected whole or naturally broken and absolutely not mechanically crushed, which is compatible with closed loop recycling. Section 34 of the Environmental Protection Act 1990 requires those handling waste to ensure that it is handled in a fashion that promotes high value recycling. Return Points, producers and Circularity Scotland, when handling return scheme packaging, including glass, will therefore have an obligation to promote high value recycling. Scotland's Code of Practice for Managing Controlled Waste makes it clear that the use of recovered glass collected, colored in remelt applications to create new glass product is considered an example of high quality recycling, and so it should be prioritized. And the current best practice is not to crush the glass, so that is not the intention.
Okay, thank you for confirming. We've also heard some concerns from parts of the industry that have raised issues around legacy containers. So by that, I mean containers of products that were produced prior to the regulations coming into play. This seems a really particular issue for producers and retailers of spirits such as whisky, and obviously because they can sit on shelves for such a long period of time. Can the Minister clarify exactly how these containers will be covered by this scheme?
Absolutely. Yeah, I understand absolutely the problem around legacy containers, particularly in the whisky industry and similar industries. The stock placed on the market before the 16th of August 2023 and therefore not deposit bearing continues to be legal for sale after that date with no end date set into the regulations. This is different from a number of other schemes which do set an end date. And we had Scottish producers such as the whisky industry very much in mind when we made this decision to allow this.
Okay. That's great. Thank you. No further questions.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Next up, Monica Lennon, to be followed by Fiona Hislop. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Minister, government is relying heavily on the gateway review, as been mentioned already. The committee's had a submission from the Association for the Protection of Rural Scotland, and they say that the gateway review and assurance plan is weak. There are many shortcomings. One of the obvious is the most skewed choice of organisations involved. They say that 40% of those spoken to were either Scottish Government or under your direct oversight. Another 40% were producers or retailers. No organisations interviewed were operators of deposit return schemes. They're also concerned that domestic and international experts were not spoken to either. They say this is the equivalent of trying to work out whether a vehicle could be fixed without speaking to a single mechanic. Are they wrong, Minister?
So during that gateway review, a wide range of stakeholders across public, private and third sectors took part in the discussions with me, my officials and or the gateway reviewers. We published a full list of the business and regulatory impact assessment. The gateway review gave a preparedness estimate of 12 to 24 months for individual stakeholders, including retailers. This informed its judgment that a full implementation date of July to September 2023 was possible, albeit with significant risk. This was reinforced by our wider stakeholder engagement. So while an individual business might be in a different position, I have considered the circumstances facing industry as a whole. It is essential that this scheme is a success, not just for the short term, but for decades to come. The Gateway review followed standard procedure and focused on what is a deliverable timetable and what recommendations a program of governance to improve the likelihood of success. We supplemented the review with meetings with a wide range of industry representatives and ENGOs, as well as drawing on wider intelligence, including evidence from other schemes.
Thank you, Minister. Well, those were the highlights of the Association for the Protection of Rural Scotland. We've also had concerns from Marine Conservation Society, and they really focus our minds on the environmental impact of your proposed delays. They remind the committee that we're in the midst of an intertwined climate emergency and nature crisis. They say that Scotland's seas and beach are bearing the brunt of the delays to DRS. What is the environmental impact of your proposed delay, Minister?
No one wishes more than me, I promise you, that it would have been possible to implement this scheme in July of 2022. So we have set forward a scheme of implementing it as quickly as practically possible. And you've seen from the Independent Gateway Review that they decide, you know, they came back with the result that July to September 2023 was the soonest possible date. And then we have worked with industry and Circularity Scotland and other stakeholders to narrow that down to the very specific middle of August 2023. So the risk of having a scheme that doesn't work, that doesn't work on day one, that is less ambitious, that for some reason does not get the public support and momentum or get retailers and producers on board, is much, much more than this unfortunate but necessary delay to make sure that the scheme works from day one, to make sure it is ambitious, that we're not watering it down. And this scheme will be with us for decades and will have a huge positive overall effect on our environment.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Monica. The next question is from Fiona Hislop, to be followed by Maurice Golden. Fiona, over to you, please.
Monica covered some of my area. I just wonder if the Minister has got any final messages to those that are concerned about the environmental impact of plastic pollution in particular, and the concerns that they have.
Thank you very much for the question. I mean, something that we're all very concerned about is not just the impact of plastic and waste when it's littered in our seas, but the cost to our local authorities of having to process this excess waste. Something that we can all look at doing it toward working toward our waste targets, reducing the total amount of waste that is produced in Scotland, is the deposit return scheme. It will have a significant impact. It will take tens of millions of pieces of plastic waste out of circulation and make sure that they're part of that high value recycling chain. This also opens up the possibility of investment in Scotland in terms of building recycling centres, in terms of all the businesses required around the logistics. So this is a really exciting step forward in circular economy and reducing waste.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Fiona. Maurice Golden, please.
Thank you, Convener. Short, simple questions from me. Minister, on what date were you aware that there would be a delay to the scheme?
As I said in my statement to Parliament on the 17th of November, myself and my state officials were at that point continuing to work really hard with Circularity Scotland and wider industry to agree a final timetable and clear milestones for delivery, including interpreting the impact of the decision from the UK government on VAT, which had just been communicated to me at that time. Having carried out that further work after that first address to Parliament, we then identified a date. This was subject of ongoing analysis and discussion between myself and various stakeholders, and we announced that date, I announced that date to Parliament on the 14th of December. It was very much the subject to ongoing assessment and review as new information came in and as we listened to different stakeholders.
So at the time of the November statement, were you aware that there would be a delay to the scheme? Yes or no?
At the time of the November statement, the matter was fully under discussion between different stakeholders and myself. It was being assessed, and I committed to doing that assessment, listening to environmental NGOs, listening to business, industry, listening to Circularity Scotland, and reading the result of the independent review. So that decision was very much under full assessment. We needed to make sure that we had spoken to everyone who mattered and all the stakeholders and taken a careful decision. So that decision was finalised when I announced it to Parliament on the 14th of December.
Was the Minister aware that Circularity Scotland Limited issued tenders prior to the November statement that had a start date for Scotland's deposit return date scheme later than 2022?
In line with the principle of producer responsibility, that is, polluter pays, Circularity Scotland is a private company. It was established by the industry to lead on the delivery of the DRS. And as an independent private company, its procurement decisions and processes are private and its business and not for government intervention.
So Circularity Scotland are proposing a date in 2023, June 2023, in October. Were you aware of that or not?
Circularity Scotland's procurement procedures as a private company are the business of Circularity Scotland, not the Scottish Government.
In the issues of transparency, which the Minister is committed to, will the Scottish Government instruct Circularity Scotland to comply with FOI requests?
As I would need to get my officials to confirm that, but again, as a private company, private companies are not subject, as far as I know, to FOI requests. Those FOI requests are for transparency within the Scottish Government.
Dear Away Scotland have a policy of generally complying with FOI requests. Who created Circularity Scotland as a private company?
Sorry, was the official going to come in on the last point there? I just saw him briefly on the screen.
Yes, I can take both those points, Minister. So, Circularity Scotland, FOI legislation and environmental information regulations to boot don't apply to Circularity Scotland as an independent private company. They were set up by a coalition of drinks producers, retailers and wholesalers back in February 2021. So they weren't set up by government. Government doesn't have a power of direction over them.
Thanks, I'm aware of that. Final question, how many staff worked for the scheme administrator in 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019 and 2020?
The scheme administrator was brought into being in 2021. So as far as I know, the business started up in 2021 and they have since been hiring staff and doing all the usual things that a startup business does.
No staff. Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Maurice. Minister, one final question from me. Well, one of the key questions in this area is where the DRS vending machines will be sourced from. Given the further delay in implementing the scheme, can you guarantee that all the DRS vending machines will be built here in Scotland, thereby avoiding high-paid manufacturing jobs and technology being offshored?
There is absolutely an interest in where the reverse vending machines are made. There is a sort of problem with sourcing them due to Brexit and other challenges. That isn't something that I'm able to guarantee because this is for Circularity Scotland and the industry to decide their own procurement procedures. But of course, we all very much hope and intend for as much of this to be done in Scotland as possible.
Okay, thank you. There are no more questions as far as I can see. So we move to our next agenda item, which is the formal consideration of motion 02582, calling for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to recommend approval of the Deposit and Return Scheme for Scotland's Amendment Regulations 2022. Minister, do you wish to speak to the motion or do you wish simply to move this motion?
I can simply move the motion.
Thank you very much. And let me ask if there are any further contributions from members in this part of the debate. If members have any contributions to make, if you could drop an R into the chat bar, that would be fantastic. Okay, so first up, Monica Lennon, please.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened very carefully to the Minister and to colleagues today, and I've read the briefings that we've had from interested stakeholders. I think it's very disappointing that we have this further delay on top of previous delays. you know, I welcome the ambition that's been taken, but this has to be more than a paper exercise. So I'm very concerned about the regulations in front of us. I would like to see the government bring this back to Parliament with a scheme that everyone can have confidence in, that takes account of the concerns raised by the organisations that I mentioned earlier on. Because as it stands, I would find it very difficult to give my backing to the proposed regulations today. So I really feel that if we are ambitious and serious, we have to find a way to make this work. And clearly, I've read out that not everyone is impressed with the gateway process. Not everyone feels included. There's been a lot of lobbying going on. I think Maurice Golden's been right to pursue questions of transparency. And again, people are not making party political points. We really want this to work. I know the Minister in her heart wants it to work, and I really think she has to think again.
Thank you, Monica. Liam Kerr would like to come in, to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wasn't actually going to speak today, but having listened to the Minister's evidence session both today and previously, I rather feel compelled to. And I might add that I think my friend Monica Lennon spoke rather well just there and made some really quite important points. My thinking is these regulations have been, half a decade in gestation, and we're now being told that they're going to be delayed again. And the Minister blames several extraneous factors, which is rather difficult to square with the reality. And I'm looking at it, I'm saying, well, look, our friends elsewhere are striding on with schemes which are constructed differently and that evidence might suggest is both effective and potentially future-proofed, going towards the question asked earlier. But the Minister's rather struggled to answer several direct questions from across the political spectrum, and the answers that have been given have rather lacked detail. I think, as Monica Lennon rightly said, we're all across the parties very keen to see a workable and effective and successful scheme as soon as possible. And of course, the Minister talks very positively about what a scheme can achieve and the benefits of it. But the detail, the depth, the finances, frankly, just remain very opaque. And I'm very concerned about that. And so I guess because this is a debate, I'd request respectfully that the Minister in closing today give some very clear details, some very clear commitments and some very clear figures on the funds, like the cost to the public purse that I asked about, in order to allay my and possibly others' significant concerns around what is being proposed.
Thank you very much. Liam, Mark Ruskell to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Look, I think it's fair to say that, you know, everybody in this committee, and I imagine the Minister as well, is, you know, concerned about the delay. I mean, the original regulations that were put in place in the 2009 Climate Act, you know, gave government the opportunity to move quickly on a DRS scheme, and that opportunity wasn't taken at the time. And I think the Minister's been put in a very difficult position with the establishment of Circularity Scotland only last summer. So I think, you know, going forward, the fact that there's a commitment now to milestones, the fact that we're going to hold Circularity Scotland to account, and I think there's a critical role for this committee to do that, I think gives me a lot of confidence that finally we have a minister who's going to actually deliver a deposit return scheme rather than it just being a vague commitment, which previous ministers have not moved quickly enough on. I think also, you know, I've read the briefings from ENGOs. I'm as frustrated as they are that this is not in place already. But, you know, we have to bear in mind that this is an incredibly ambitious scheme. This is the most ambitious scheme in Europe. It's not as if we're following the path of other, you know, small countries who maybe put in place a scheme for plastic bottles to start with larger retailers, and then they've maybe considered moving over to cans, or maybe then considered online, and then perhaps adding the addition of glass at a later date. This is an all-singing, all-dancing, ambitious scheme that we're trying to deliver in the quickest time possible. So it's a hugely ambitious scheme that Parliament agreed way back in 2019. So I think what would be really disappointing today, if there were members of this committee who are then going to effectively turn down this SI and are going to effectively vote down progress on a deposit return scheme, because all that will do is it will create even more delay. It will force government to go back, reconsider the scheme right from square one again. It will create uncertainty. for business, and that ultimately is going to impact on our environment. It's going to impact on our marine environment. It's going to impact on climate change as well. I mean, Monica Lennon says she wants to make it work. Well, so do I. We're all disappointed we are where we are, but we've got an opportunity now to move at pace. I want it to work as well, and that's why I'm going to be voting for it. And I hope other members will as well. That's me.
Thank you very much, Mark. Thank you. Fiona Hislop to be followed by Maurice Golden, please. Fiona.
So Liam Kerr said the regulations are being delayed again. No, the regulations will only be delayed then if this committee doesn't approve them and if the Parliament doesn't approve them. This is a hugely important scheme to tackle waste in Scotland. Undoubtedly, there have been challenges and indeed some disappointments along the way in delivering this. But in terms of the innovation and the reach of what this scheme can deliver, I can tell the committee that already in my constituency, Aldi, the supermarket chain, are already introduced their first pilot deposit return scheme. So Scotland wants us to get on with this. And yes, we need to scrutinise, and I would recommend, and listening to committee colleagues, that this committee does take a strong line in the scrutiny and the development and the implementation of this scheme. But you know, this Parliament has a duty and responsibility to tackle waste, to drive forward our agenda on net zero and wider environmental issues. And I strongly recommend that the committee votes in favour of the statutory instrument.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Maurice Golden, please. Maurice, over to you.
Thank you, convener. Just to make the committee aware that there are some really ambitious schemes being delivered throughout Europe. Wales, Northern Ireland, Portugal are trialling digital. Latvia have a more traditional but more ambitious deposit return scheme with refillables and standardised bottles. But I have real concerns about the delivery of this scheme. It appears as if the Minister isn't in control of Circularity Scotland, and therefore how can we as parliamentarians have any confidence that this shambolic scheme shrouded in secrecy can actually be delivered? It's worth noting that the Scottish Government could have set up an independent body, a non-departmental public body to deliver this scheme, but they chose to create a private company that then refuses to reply to FOIs, which I've sent in. And there's a big question here on the secrecy angle. If Circularity Scotland is issuing tenders with a launch date of June 2023 in October, and the Minister isn't aware of that, how can we possibly be assured that this scheme, with this new delay, will be delivered on that date? I would urge members to not vote for this delay at this time until these questions around transparency are answered. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Maurice, I think that's the end of the contributions from members and attendees. So, Minister, can I pass back to you to sum up on the debate, please?
Thank you very much. And I appreciate the depth of feeling on this and everybody's frustration with delays. As I said earlier, there is no one who wishes more than I was that it had been possible to keep with the original July 2022 date. So I completely understand that. The plans that are currently on the table with the milestones agreed with Circularity Scotland, including really ambitious things like getting the IT systems in place, buying these sorting centres, setting those up, setting up all the logistics and registering the 35,000 retailers in Scotland that need to sign up for the scheme, acquiring the reverse vending schemes, I am confident that we can deliver this by the new date, by August 2023, and that that is indeed the quickest possible timeline. In fact, that date potentially comes with some risks, especially for small businesses and breweries that have struggled so much during the pandemic. The whole point of this scheme, which is, I understand Mr. Golden's frustrations, but it is an industry-led scheme. So this is on the principle that the polluter pays. So rather than having the public purse, taxpayers' money, which we know, you know, that we live in a time of scarce resources, being used to set this scheme up, industry is setting the scheme up themselves, which has the advantage of meaning that industry is paying for it. But it does mean, of course, that it is one step removed from government and not subject to FOI and so forth. But it has the advantage that it has industry expertise. And they are absolutely incentivized to bring in this scheme, not only philosophically because they understand the importance of the environment, but because this scheme will generate something in the order of £600 million per year in Scotland. There is a lot of money to be made in this, and industry knows that. It is going to be a good boost for industry overall, with a lot of opportunities for business in Scotland. And industry know this and support it. And we have agreed this timeline. I really hope that this committee will support the new timeline, because it is our best chance of getting this ambitious scheme in as soon as possible.
Thank you very much, Minister. The question, therefore, is that motion 02582, in the name of the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity, be approved. Are we all agreed? If any member is not agreed, please indicate this in the chat bar. I see that we are not agreed, and we will therefore move to a division. Since we are voting remotely, I suggest we have a quick roll call for each member to confirm their voting intention. Let me do this in alphabetical order, and a reminder that the choices for members are yes, no, or abstain. In alphabetical order, first up is Jackie Dunbar.
Yes.
Natalie Dawn.
Yes.
Fiona Hislop.
Yes.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, convener. Ambition is not delivering, and the minister hasn't answered the questions posed by Maurice Golden in particular. So on this, I am going to abstain, convener.
Thank you, Liam. Monica Lennon?
No.
I'm next in alphabetical order. I will also abstain on the instrument. Mark Ruskell, please.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. According to the members voting, the result is yes, 4, no, votes against 1, and there were 2 abstentions. The committee will therefore report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Is that agreed? Thank you. Minister, that ends this session on the statutory instrument. Thank you for attending, and also thank you to the officials and Mr. Golden for attending this session. I now suspend the meeting briefly in order to prepare for the next item. Welcome back, everyone. For our next agenda item, we welcome our third set of witnesses in relation to the committee's inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sector partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. Today, we have representatives from the business sector and the finance sector. For our first panel, I'm very pleased to welcome Tracy Black, Scotland Director, the Confederation of British Industry, and Barry McCulloch, Head of Policy, Federation of Small Businesses Scotland. Thank you both very much for accepting our invitation, and we're delighted you are able to join us this morning. Apologies, we are running slightly behind schedule. We have just about over an hour for this panel session, and we'll move straight to questions. And the first question I have relates to the interaction between the business sector and local authorities in delivering net zero targets. During COP26 in Glasgow, we heard about the increasingly important role of the business sector in delivering net zero. And when it comes to the role of local authorities, in previous evidence sessions of this committee, we heard concerns about whether local authorities have the necessary capacity, expertise, and resource to deliver on ambitious net zero targets, including in the areas of planning, procurement, transport, and heat in buildings. So my question to the panel is, how do these challenges and the limitations faced by local authorities impact on your members in terms of their own transition to net zero, but also in terms of their wider ability to contribute to meeting national targets, national net zero targets here in Scotland? And I'll put that question first to Tracy and then to Barry. So Tracy, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. And that is a very large question with a lot of parts to it, so I'll do my best. There is no doubt we've seen across our members a step change in the last 2 to 3 years. And I think COP was a great demonstration of that, of the huge attendance by business at it. And that we sort of see that, you know, governments are obviously crucial at laying out what the ambition is, what the plan is, but it will be business ultimately to implement a lot of that policy. I think your question around the local authorities and business working together, an interesting one. Before coming today, I've gone out extensively to my members, and I think while there are lots of good examples of partnership going on out there, for example, I know the Net Zero Technology Centre up in Aberdeen has been working very well using the sort of city funding and with business. We've also got members of ours who are working as ambassadors around the circular economy with Glasgow City Council. The overwhelming feedback from our members is that there has been very or little engagement, proactive engagement from the local authorities. Now, there's a lot of understanding around this. Resourcing is definitely an issue that we're hearing loud and clear. Scottish Renewables did some research recently which has shown that number of council planners employed in Scotland has fallen by 20% in the last sort of 9 years. So there is a deep concern about the ability to do change at pace with those constraints on the local authorities. There's also a big concern around the skills issue. Technology is changing rapidly. The processes, the systems used are changed, and therefore the ability, and it's not a criticism, it is the fact that both private and public sector are facing this challenge of how do you keep the skills base up within the local authorities to be able to judge and assess, you know, new proposals are coming through. And that is another key message I would say that we've heard from our members, is that it's often them that's driving the conversation with the local authorities. And although there's a presumption that they will be favourable towards new and innovative builds, for example, the reality is that often that even with lots of extensions of consultation at the last minute can fail or be put on hold because of a planning decision. So I think what we're seeing is a very complex situation. I'm sure over the hour we'll delve into some of these things more deeply, but the business appetite is there. One of the other points I wanted to get across, convener, is if you look at drivers for change, and all of our studies are showing that, yes, we have this moral imperative, this is a global crisis, but if you want business to adapt and change rapidly, you need an executive that is educated and bought into it. But more importantly, or as importantly, there needs to be a business opportunity there for them to do so. Without that opportunity, there are too many other pressures, whether that is not having enough staff, the rising costs in supply chains, the energy crisis in itself. So it's very important that local government and the Scottish Government are clear to business what the opportunities are and how they can engage with them. I think is going to be a major factor in how fast we go at this. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Tracy, for that answer. And Barry, if I could put the same question to you, please.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to other committee members. I think the question's a very relevant one, given that we only have 8 years or so to cut our emissions by 70%, and we have ambitious climate change targets on the books. And I think that as far as our members are concerned, I think the gap that exists in advice and support and financial incentivisation is not necessarily one that will be provided by local government. And I think it's also important to build on what Tracy said, albeit realising that the members of FSB are different from the members of CBI, that many local businesses are already on the journey to net zero and have taken significant steps to reduce waste and increase recycling, become more energy efficient and enable home working. But in a common theme that we have with local authorities and our discussions with them on this, COVID-19 has had a huge impact both on our ability to make material progress, but also to execute the plans that were being developed prior to the pandemic. And whilst there has been engagement with the city councils in particular around the circular economy or indeed measures to improve air quality, many of those plans have been put on hold because many local authorities have been allocating their scarce resource to supporting businesses hardest by the crisis. And I think, as we heard in the previous sessions, we're at this crunch point where local authorities, in conjunction with the local business community, have to bring forward ambitious plans that detail quite clearly what they need to do and the role of businesses within that. And Tracy made a really good point, Convener, that's worth reflecting on. And I think clarity is the key word here. So the need to tackle climate change is absolutely bought in by many local businesses. What that means is quite unclear. In some cases, we have a stronger understanding of certain themes of what we might need to do, particularly around transport, heating buildings, or even in our workforce. But the policy levers and the interventions that will help businesses do that don't really exist at the moment, and there's a lot of work we have to do to try and help businesses do what they're situated and prepared to do at the moment.
Thanks very much, Barry, and for both of those answers, because you've picked up on a number of issues that members will want to explore in their questions in the hour ahead. I'd like to focus on this issue of an absence of guidance, detailed implementation guidance, and look at, for example, the heat and building strategy, because in my mind, this will require the conversion of, you know, tens of thousands of business premises, large and small, across Scotland in the years ahead. You know, the target is 2030, which doesn't give a lot of time for such a massive undertaking. Are your members getting enough clarity and support from local authorities, from the Scottish Government, in terms of what this will involve, in terms of the financial support available, and what actually needs to happen in practice? I think we all understand what the kind of final target is, what the end destination is, but my sense is there's very little detailed guidance on the ground in terms of what this massive conversion will involve. And Tracy, first to you and then to Barry.
Yeah, I think it's a really good point in that, you know, a large number of our, or the majority of our businesses are probably in older building stock for a start. So one, there's already a lot of debate, I think confusion about what solutions will actually work for those type of buildings. You know, we talk about bringing in heat pumps to domestic buildings, but we already know that in a Victorian house, how effective are they? So I think that education piece to reassure that whether you're a private household or you're a business, you're making a considerable investment there. Is the technology going to work is a big one, but also knowing what are your options, I think at the moment is quite vague. And so therefore, if you've got a heating system that works, is effective, I can see for many companies, it's like, well, will I stick with what I have till I'm really sure it's really clear, as in trying to get that fast first mover advantage, I don't really see at the moment. There's also complications around business rates, where if buildings are improved with new improved sort of greener solutions, you can be subject to a higher rate. So you improve your building and then you pay more business rates. But that's not exactly a clear incentive. And I know they've made announcements at the end of last year for Down South to make changes to that. And we would be advising a similar approach in Scotland to encourage businesses. You've also got that challenge, I think, between obviously a lot of businesses don't necessarily own the building that they're operating out of. So is it for the tenant to make the improvements, or is it the landlord has to make it, I think is another challenge there. And I think this is the thing, like it's, you know, we're predominantly an SME country, and Barry will know this better than I do, but we know that over 98% of our businesses are SME. But you think of, you know, I always go back to, you know, the mechanics, the hairdressers and the chefs, you know, our hairdressers across the country are probably all using gas boilers to heat their hot water. What is really the option for them? The mechanics are, you know, tens of thousands of them out there have spent large sums of money on equipment for diesel and petrol engine cars. They're now going to have to invest into equipment for electric vehicles. And pretty much every kitchen across the country at a catering level will be using gas. So what are the options to them? What are the, you know, induction options for catering? And then, of course, there's the big waste issue that we're going to create from that, Convener. Many of our members will talk about, you know, if we remove these thousands and thousands of boilers, do the local authorities have the capacity to recycle all of them? What are we going to do with all that new waste that we are going to create? So this is very complex, but first and foremost, that clear direction, I think, from Scottish Government and local authorities about what are the solutions, giving them advice where to go, what technology will work, and what's the real cost. Because if you have early adopters, and the technology isn't fit for purpose, it will really then slow down other people coming forward and making the same decisions. So that peer learning, I think, is going to be very critical as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Tracy. As you see, an enormous number of very complex issues to be addressed, and actually not a huge number of time, a huge amount of time to address those issues. Barry, if I could ask the same question of you, please.
The challenges to decarbonise a non-domestic properties are absolutely massive, and the timescales are incredibly tight. It's a commitment that will require billions of pounds worth of investment, either from the private sector or the public sector. And whilst the destination, as you put it, Convener, is somewhat well known, the way in which we get there, the route that different businesses will have to take, whether they are tenants or landlords, and what that looks like, I don't think that truly exists. Work is ongoing within Scottish Government to provide those practical details, but that route map that local businesses require needs to be urgently brought to the table. And I think there's the issue that Tracy picked on is one that is worth dwelling on a little bit in terms of ownership. And, you know, in research that my Westminster colleagues published last year on this subject ahead of COP26, you know, it points out that about 20% of our members are not able to make even straightforward practical improvements to their energy efficiency because of the agreement that they have with their landlord. And so I think there's a lot to unpick and understand in terms of the dynamics between who owns a property, what the tenant can practically do, so they don't put themselves in a disadvantaged position. And then lastly, there's this COVID angle, which we're talking to government more and more, and this tension between ventilation and its importance to make our workplaces and premises safe. And that will be a multi-year commitment, and we have a 25 million ventilation fund that was launched last year, versus a need to further insulate our quite often dated historic non-domestic properties. And that creates confusion in the marketplace. And so you have many FSB members coming to the FSB team asking for advice on, so I'm being told to open windows, make sure doors can be kept open, install air bricks, whilst at the same time I have people coming in to make sure that my property is well insulated. And whilst we might understand why both those things are important, I think your average local business owner who's juggling many, many different plates need that spelled out very, very clearly. I think just lastly, convener, that they are of course massive procurement opportunities that could be generated if we manage this process properly. And ahead of the elections last year, we put forward this approach for our neighbourhoods, neighbourhood approach to procurement, whereby we do non-domestic and domestic properties on an area-by-area basis, making sure that we don't just aggregate contracts and that we give SMEs who are more than equipped to help, whether that's central heating engineers or indeed firms that could install secondary glazing or new windows. You know, we need to use the local businesses that we have and make sure that the benefits stay within Scotland as much as possible.
Okay, thank you very much both for those responses. You raised a number of points that I think members want to come in on. So let me bring in other members. First of all, Fiona Hislop, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Fiona, over to you, please.
Good morning, both of you. What are the top council planning practice and regulation changes that would be most helpful for your membership to help deliver net zero in the short term and also the long term? So I can maybe come to Tracy first and then to Barry. Tracy?
I think one of the key things we get is, you know, a lot of our members operate across the local authorities and actually operate across the UK. So actually, where possible, standardisation across the local authorities when it comes to whether that's technologies that would be approved or new systems. So I think everybody gets that the look and feel, say, for example, of a building can vary hugely of what's acceptable from, you know, beside a lock to in a city. So, there's the planning side. But I think on the building standards piece, that's one of the key things, that if you could see consistency of approach across the local authorities would really speed up, adoption. The second is just reducing the time it takes to get these decisions made. Now, you know, we know the big infrastructure projects, you know, so whether it's the wind farms, et cetera, can be 10 years in the process. And it's because there's a lot of sequential decision making. You know, first it goes through government, then it goes through regulator, and then it goes through planning. And everybody can be in agreement, and it can still come down to the local planning officer going no, even though that you've work through the whole process. This is not about trying to cut corners, or it's just about how can we improve and speed up the process to get the ground dug up and start going, or make the amendments to change. So I think our key ask would be, one, as I say, where possible, that learning. And also, I think there's, at the end of the day, there's a huge skills challenge here for the local authorities. As I say, it's widespread. This is a global problem. Can every building standards officer really have the time to get to the same level, learn all the skills? Or is there a way that you could have, you know, groups across the local authorities that are experts in certain things that advise, that you can sort of speed up that learning? So I think that peer learning, that sharing of resources and knowledge, and somehow reducing down that decision making. But there also has to be an increased commercial awareness. We had an example of a member who had worked very closely with the local authority. It's a sustainable, multi-million pound sustainable business, supported by the Scottish Government, by students to large sums of money, but also private funding. And for example, that private funding was conditional on getting the planning by a specific date. Now, even working really closely with that local authority, the planning officer did not approve that planning permission by the date that had all been agreed, and therefore £5.5 million of funding was at stake, and not just the funding, but the company was at stake. So there needs to be an awareness of that significant impact to a business that these delays that can come out of the local authorities, because, as I say, we're going to see thousands of applications going in. And actually, sorry, one other thing I suppose we wanted to get across was also there's what can we speed up in permitted development. So a major supermarket wants to be sort of one of the biggest providers of EV charging points. They've bought and are rolling out standard well-known EV charging points. It comes under permitted development in England. In Scotland, their class is being too tall. So every single EV charging point that they want to roll out at every single store across Scotland has to go through planning. And yet the perception of how we could even change that, that effectively that 32 local authorities could come together and go, you know what, that's madness. They're 20 centimetres too tall. Let's just agree, seems to be really challenging. The same on packaging. We know from retailers that we could see much more. One of the biggest things is consumers not knowing what can be recycled. And yet our local authorities all have different colours of bins, which makes it really hard for consumers to know what can go in what bin. So something as simple as, can we just agree that the local authorities all have green recycling bins? They all have black landfill bins. Seems like a huge task to overcome in Scotland. And it's things like that, you know, things that are pretty simple. Can we just make it happen rather than it taking years to debate and get nowhere? Thank you. Sorry, that was a very long answer.
Thank you, very comprehensive. And I'll come to Barry McCullough on that.
Thank you. Tracy made good points about standardisation and the need for prompt decision making. But in truth, Ms. Hislop, small businesses don't see the planning system as necessarily a barrier to growth or indeed their adoption to net zero, because as you'll know, most local businesses are putting in smaller scale applications for small alterations to their buildings and are on the whole infrequent users of the planning system. I think there's an interesting discussion about the indirect impact that local businesses experience as a result of the decisions taken by planning authorities. And there's quite a right discussion that we could have about the impact of town centre first policies and the decisions that planning authorities have taken to enable out-of-town developments, where we're constructing, in essence, new infrastructure at the expense of the infrastructure that exists within the town, which was a finding from a Scottish Government expert group that I sat on for FSB that looked into towns last year. And I think there's some interesting policy discussions to be had around that, and perhaps a need to look more seriously about that. I think also there's certainly mileage in investigating what more we can do to extend permitted development. And Tracy made a good point about the charging points, but there's also something we can look to in terms of how the planning system responded to COVID-19. And you know, the Chief Planning Officer effectively enabled lots of alterations at speed, giving the planning authorities the space and the legal clarity to allow a lot of local businesses to move quickly. And I think there's something in that where we can look to how we enabled firms to pivot and adapt very quickly within set confines, working with local government to the challenge that we have now, because it is a climate emergency. And we do need to think about what more can we do at pace and in and around our local businesses and local economies.
I have a separate question, Convener. Are you wanting to bring Mark Russell in this, or can I move on?
Fiona, why don't you have your question, then I'll bring Mark in after your second question. Thank you.
We've heard about the importance of speed and scale and collaboration between the public sector, local councils and private companies and co-investment in net zero schemes. And that's going to be key to deliver net zero. And we've heard that in this committee. In the Economy Committee at the same time, we've also heard about the potential risk aversion by councils due to the centralised subsidy control bill currently going through Westminster. Now, we need subsidy control, but we also need to ensure the pace and ambition and clarity has been mentioned of what can be delivered in local areas. Mm-hmm. we realised being developed for net by the Scottish Government would be helpful in pushing ahead with that speed and scale and collaboration and co-investment of councils and business for some of these net zero schemes. Then, first of all, to Tracy, and then to Tracy Black, and then to Brian McCullough. Tracy?
I'm really sorry, you know, my screen froze just at the point you were saying the question. Could you just re-give me the question? So
it's basically about the speed and the scale of co-investment between councils and private companies being really important to deliver on net zero. And obviously, we've got a subsidy control bill going through Westminster. We want subsidy control. We understand the importance of subsidy control. But if there's a risk aversion because of the nature of that system, that could stop some of the scale and the speed of the joint co-investment between private companies and councils. In previous types of co-investments between councils and private companies, there have been streamlined schemes that can help get rapid approval. And if clarity is one of the issues that people need to move forward in tackling net zero, is some kind of streamlined for approvals for subsidy between councils and local authorities, something that your membership would be welcome. If you want to come back to us on that, happy that you do so, but it is something that's very live in the Parliament just now.
Yeah, I'm sort of trying to think what the correct response is. I probably would want to go back and just speak to the team. I think, you know, when we talk about and I don't know if this is directly answering the question, but it's one of the points I wanted to make today, is there is no doubt at the moment, and this probably isn't answering the problem, but, you know, just the fact is, you know, we're leaders in offshore wind because we subsidised it very well. We're now having to move to much smaller products. You know, every product that we have in our house will change. Thousands of products that we use every day use petrochemicals. And the reality is green products are more expensive. There's just no doubt about it. Now, hopefully through scale, the cost will come down. So there is a big question we constantly get asked by our members, is that the business opportunity needs to be clear. I need to know that the consumer, the client, and that could be through procurement and local authority, or it could be through the general public, are going to buy a more expensive product. And what we're seeing at the moment is they're not. So if you look at house extensions, and when I speak to my construction companies, if it's about getting the highest spec green insulation, etc., or the cosmetics, the granite worktops, they will consistently go for the granite worktops. So there has to be this, how do we make the green option comparable to the petrochemical equivalent? It's the same when we look at biochemicals versus their petrochemical equipment. They're just more expensive. So I think we do have to get quite innovative on how do we lever that. Now, it's a big topic. You know, do you use VAT? Do you use taxation as a way of leveling it up? You know, but in this next 8 years, I think that's going to be a real challenge for us, is how do you get that business demand when people can't quite see the value. There's another thing around, like, if I look at the house builders, they just know that they can create really energy efficient housing, but again, they'll cost more and they'd rather have the better kitchen. So things like the energy performance certificates, you know, can we put in there that actually, rather than just saying it's energy efficient, it will save you £1,700 in gas bills each year. So I think there's just, you know, for us, it's been clear what the opportunity is, but whether it's through procurement or if it's consumers, there has to be a way of levelling up the playing field between the green offer versus the petrochemical offer at the moment, because at the moment they're just not fair. So I think a streamlined scheme for approval in principle sounds like a good thing, and I think more detail. But let me come back on that. But there is this problem that the consumer is a couple of steps behind business, I feel, on this one. I don't know if that helps you, but that's something that's going on in my head.
And it'd be good to hear back from you on that. And for yourself, Barry, particularly for small businesses, maybe doing joint projects with councils that involve some kind of subsidy or incentive from the council, how do we try and avoid risk aversion for competition and subsidy issues?
I think that there may be delays caused to co-investment by the new subsidy control regime. I have to confess that it's not an issue that's crossed our desks at the moment, but I'm not happy to pick that up with you separately. Mm. I think what I can say is that thinking about this issue over the last few years, EU state aid also caused an issue, and that there's always been this threshold at which either local authorities or other public partners begin to get nervous because of the de minimis regime that yeah. ran. And I think there's a really interesting discussion to be had about the function and operation of the Scottish National Investment Bank in that space. And I think that's certainly for many FSB members, they will look to the bank in partnership with big finance providers as a way in which to finance their net zero ambitions. But I would caveat that by saying that I sense that there may be a reticence to take out debt finance or indeed equity finance as a result of the £4 billion worth of debt finance that many small businesses took out from the BBL scheme in response to COVID. And I think a new model may need to be created to try and encourage businesses to co-invest. And I would highlight the fantastic success of the Digibus scheme ran by the Scottish Government, which started at a level of 100% grant, and then has slowly tapered that down. And as it's tapered it down, the demand hasn't dampened. And I think there's something to be looked at in terms of how we can use that within the green economy space as a way to tangibly encourage businesses to, whether that's to tackle their energy efficiency or indeed replace a vehicle, because a lot of the tools and resources we relied on pre-COVID were really zero interest bank loans, either through the Energy Savings Trust or others. Now, I'm just not sure what the appeal of that will be going forward, given how difficult business is for many members at the moment.
Thank you very much, Barry, and I'll now hand back to the convener.
Great. Thank you, Fiona. I think Mark Ruskell had a supplemental in some of this, so let me bring in Mark to be followed by Veronica Lennon.
Yeah, thanks, Camille. Just a quick one. I was reflecting on Tracy's last answer. I mean, presumably, I mean, you're in favour of the free market, right? So there will be market-based solutions here. And I'm interested in what your attitude is then to regulation, because if you're talking about leveling up effectively, creating a new level playing field, surely increased regulation does that. It provides certainty for business, but it also then says, well, okay, that means that we're going to need to, you know, grow and innovate in the market around low carbon heating systems or insulation or whatever to actually bring that cost down for consumers and suppliers. But I'm interested in your views on where, you know, that regulation sits in this and whether that really can drive innovation and drive cost reduction.
Market conditions, because time isn't our friend on this one to let us play it out. We've got this very, very, you know, tight line of, you know, a number of years. You know, there's plenty of experts who will say that, you know, if we don't achieve where we need to get to radically in the next 10 years, we will sort of miss the point. So I think it's not a sort of normal situation where you can, you know, everything has got to be done at pace, which is the real challenge here. So we've got a problem potentially where regulations actually and policy will move at a much faster pace than the skills and innovation required. So that's another challenge we've got. So we could say to all food manufacturers, you've got to use recycling packaging, and the same for the drug manufacturers. But the reality that packaging does not exist at the moment. It's not a case of they don't want to, it's not a case that it's too expensive. There just isn't a drug standard plastic being invented. So there's a lot of different things going on at play that holds back, I think, that sort of free market economy. Bill Gates has spent millions of pounds trying to improve battery technology. They've sort of come to the conclusion it just cannot be done. I think one of the key messages we've got about regulation, and actually it's the regulators as well, need to absolutely modernise. There is an awful lot of discussion going on about that, of course, in the energy sector at the moment, is that you need a regulator that has also got net zero at the heart of its framework, that ties in with the government's ambitions that then can work with the business on the ground. So I think my point is, I actually think there is huge appetite now. I think that actually the business case for net zero has been made, and that for certainly larger businesses, there is huge opportunity there. And ScotWind is a fantastic example of how excited business is to invest in Scotland. While I took lots of calls last Monday from members of ours who had been successful in the ScotWind bid, I also had a number of calls from businesses that were devastated that they weren't writing enormous checks to the Crown Estate. So there's there is masses of appetite in there. And what we have to be very clear of is that we don't lose that 60 odd companies that missed out, because there are opportunities all over the globe. So one is how for business investment that wants to come in, how we keep that cycle. But I think one of the challenges we have, Mr. Russell, is not having enough opportunities. There's not nearly enough big opportunities across the UK and Scotland. We want to see more of that. But there'll also be some projects that are just not that attractive. How do you fund them? Maybe the very niche, the very local, and that's going to be much, much harder, I think. And that's where we've seen, certainly down south, it's really led the local authorities that are doing this well. It's often led by an individual who's got that dynamism, who think of putting creative packages together. And I think that's quite a risky approach, that it comes down to just individuals. We need that strategy and policy, let's say, that lays out that opportunity with good regulation that is reflective of where we need to go to. And at the moment, a lot of the regulation is 10, 20 years out of date for a modern green economy. Thank you.
I think it was Barry wanting to come in as well.
Thank you. To complement that answer, and just to reflect on a couple of the previous sessions, I think there was a common theme coming through for me, that local authorities do not expect the Scottish Government to finance the entire transition to net zero at a local authority level. And many of them, the city council leaders, made the point that a lot of the funding will have to come from the private sector. And I think within that space, it's just worth flagging up that many local businesses who, before the crisis, were permanent non-borrowers, so they didn't take out any debt finance or any equity finance, will not be sitting here at the moment wondering how they're going to finance the transition to a net zero economy. I mean, they're very much in the space, like households across the country, trying to figure out what advice is needed, what support is required, and what will the financial assistance to that be like. And within that space, I think there's a lot of policy interventions going to be required throughout the 2020s and the 2030s to help the smallest businesses who will find it disproportionately difficult to make those targets. And I've got particular sympathy for the businesses who've been hit particularly hard by COVID-19. And I think there's a really important discussion about how we make that transition just for those businesses and give them the tools to decarbonise their operations.
Okay, we'll go back to Convener.
Great, thank you very much, Mark. Let me bring in Monica Lennon to be followed by Liam Kerr. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our panel. Procurement has been mentioned today already, but I wanted to focus on that for a moment or two. We've heard some of the challenges and we've had some good briefings on that, but I wonder if you could maybe talk about some of the positives that we've seen around procurement, particularly in terms of the implementation of the sustainable procurement duty, and in terms of the challenges, which sounds like they might be around skills and knowledge. What needs to happen? What are your top asks of local government and central government on that? Go to Barry first.
I'll come in first. Grace has been going first for much of this. So I suppose the answer to that question really depends on the type of business that we're talking about. And as you touched on, net zero is a huge opportunity for lots of small businesses that will be absolutely central to the drive to net zero, whether it's retrofitting homes and premises, installing new heating systems, building new transport hubs. The list is long, but it is worth considering how few small local businesses win public contracts and that despite the previous procurement legislation, not enough local businesses are winning contracts. So our number one line on this, as it is in other issues, is that we want more local businesses to win public contracts. We want contracts to be broken into smaller lots. You know, we want local authorities, as some are already doing, the likes of North Ayrshire, to stimulate that demand if it isn't there in the local economy. You know, so how do we make sure that the proceeds and the benefits of net zero can stay within local economies? And that's why we, within our manifesto for the elections last year, tried to talk to as many interested parties on how we could think about procurement and that place-based model, and not make the mistakes of the past where, you know, in terms of what we need to do in warm homes, going, you know, we've got this target in 2030, we need to do X homes, and we need cost efficiencies to stem from that, given the amount of money that has been pumped into the NHS and businesses in terms of COVID relief. And I think with the local government elections just around the corner, there's a lot to do to A, get local authorities to basically spend more with the local businesses, B, to stimulate the demand that is there, and C, also use that demand as a way to build more community wealth. And, you know, as the community wealth building agendas, you know, we've got a lot of synergies with what we're talking about just now. But for too many local businesses, procurement's a complex and costly endeavour, and they can't necessarily write off the thousands of pounds it will take to bid for contracts. I think how we make that process easier and how we discuss with local businesses what the opportunities are is something that we're very keen to build on with local authority partners.
Great, thank you, Barry, and good to hear community wealth building being mentioned there. Tracy, over to you.
Yeah, like we see procurement playing a huge role in this, in that there are massive benefits in developing that local supply chain, developing the local skills. There's a couple of, and I'm sure they won't mind me mentioning, a couple of really exciting projects that Balfour Beatty are working on at the moment, with the prison in Inverness and the Botanical Gardens in Edinburgh, which are both net zero construction sites, hugely ambitious, using state-of-the-art technology, machinery that they've developed. And they're basically like case study sites. Like, they will be open that they're learning, the local authority is learning, their suppliers are learning from those sites. So, you know, hopefully going forward, the learnings from those two projects can be used. And I think that ability of these sort of local authority projects to showcase, you know, what can be achieved to other construction companies, via, you know, is hugely valuable. I think we also, though, do have to realise that we will really slow ourselves down if we only learn from within Scotland, in that the whole world is doing this. So you know, at the CBI, we talk about being magpies. You know, what can we learn from other parts of the UK or learn from other parts of the world? So I sat on a panel last year, maybe the year, I lose time with COVID, but at our urban revival conference with Exeter City Council, who started looking at passive house standards for their social housing because of the huge fuel poverty challenge they had in the city. You know, fast forward 13 years, they will be building another 1,000 passive house homes in the city. It has significantly reduced fuel poverty for those people who are living in them. Now, at the beginning, they had to go out of Exeter to get that experience, to get that skill sets to build those type of properties. But of course, what's happened is it's given confidence to the local construction supply chain that there is an order pipeline there. They've developed the skills. And now Exeter are also moving over to doing community buildings. I think they're doing a leisure centre at the moment, which not only will be energy efficient, but will also be cheaper to run in the long term. So I think it's very much us being open to talking and working with the whole of the UK and looking beyond. We might have to bring expertise into Scotland or into our local authority, but hopefully by working with experts at this, we can really develop that local, you know, schools and jobs. A couple of feedback, though, like from a member of ours who is, you know, a sort of real expert in this type of thing. One of their points around procurement is that, understandably, often the people in procurement can't be experts in everything they're procuring. So to add sustainability on top of that now as a requirement will be a real challenge, I think, to get, you know, the procurement skill base up. And there's certainly a perception from some of our smaller members who do win procurement contracts across Scotland that the price per annum is still the main factor in procurement with looking at the implications. So basically they're saying a greener product with initial cost of £10 and a long-term cost of £15 would still lose out to a less green product with initial cost of £8 but a long-term cost of £18. So we do need to look at that modelling in procurement when assessing, you know, green solutions. I think that you look at that overall long-term benefit and cost would be a couple of the key points our members wanted to make around procurement. Thank you.
Thank you, Tracy. And that was a really interesting example about Passive House from Exeter. I know that Alec Rowley, MSP, has a proposal for a members bill on that, so hopefully he'll read the official report today. I know we don't have a lot of time, so my second question was around the Scottish National Investment Bank, and I think Barry mentioned the bank in response to Fiona Hislop earlier on. So really just to get your views, maybe just keep it very, very brief because I think we are short on time, but just your views on how the Scottish National Investment Bank, you know, what its role is in terms of supporting SMEs in particular and delivering net zero objectives. I think Barry was trying to maybe come back in on Tracy's point, but I'll hand over to Barry first. You seem keen.
Great. Thank you for that. So I think in terms of SNIB, you know, we at FSB we're completely bought into the bank's mission to encourage more SMEs to take on debt and equity finance. And there's an obvious market failure issue there that the bank's trying to fill. But in complete honesty, I'm not really sure sitting here a couple of years after COVID what the bank's doing for SMEs, because I think during the build phase, there were some exciting conversations about its role in providing place-based finance for that mission. So whether that's regenerating town centres or trying to change the use of city centres. And there's obviously been over £200 million allocated to the bank from the Scottish Government, you know, in the previous 2 years and for the next 8 years. So we're talking about a lot of money. And I think at that point, we were quite excited about the opportunities that the bank might provide for long-term investment into places that, you know, frankly, have seen better days and have struggled to adapt to the modern economy through no fault of their own. But now I don't think the bank's very much focused on burnishing its credentials as a major player in the finance market. So and that's important. But many of the members in the last last year or so that have approached the bank have either waited some time for a response because the bank were still at that point where they were trying to upskill and expand their headcount, or we're told that they weren't really the right vehicle. And so it's there's that customer experience, which we will build on as more and more businesses go to the bank. But I think at the moment, it's too early to tell. But I also think there's a lot of confusion in the small business community about what the bank can do for it, because a lot of the discussion before the bank was created was about how this is going to be a bank for SMEs. And I don't think we're really clear whether or not it is and how it's going to be, if that helps, Monica Lennon.
Yes, it does. Thank you, Barry. And Tracy, any thoughts on SNIB?
Yeah, I think it's very unfortunate that obviously it's sort of pretty much launched during a pandemic, so it's been particularly a challenging time for them. You know, from talking with them, I think, you know, the clear thing is that they shouldn't be investing in areas where it's easy to get private sector investment. So there are lots of green projects that I've talked about that have got already huge interest, can easily be funded, whether it's offshore wind, etc. But the reality with net zero and reaching sustainability is we don't have a lot of the solutions yet. A lot of the technology hasn't been invented, which means somebody has got to have the risk appetite to take that leap of faith. And I sort of see SNIB being able to play that role, particularly with innovative SMEs that have got a good business case, a good structure, a good product, but has maybe never been tried before, because to win at net zero and becoming sustainable will mean lots of failure. And nobody wants to talk about that, but you just need to look at innovation over the last 200 years. Most inventions go nowhere. So I think SNIB plays a really good role at some of those more challenging, maybe unattractive projects, which will be there that just aren't quite as exciting, but will be essential for us meeting the targets. But I hope that they have the risk appetite and are allowed to fail. You know, if everybody jumps on them, that if every investment doesn't turn into being a success story, I think that will really hamstring us. We have to allow SNIB to, as they take those brave steps into some really good innovative solutions and see where it goes. You know, as long as, I say, there's a good business case there, a good team behind it, and I say leave the easier stuff and the stuff that everybody wants to get into to the market to deal with.
Thank you, Tracy and Barry. Convener, I'll hand back to you.
That's great, Monica. Thanks very much. Next up is Liam Kerr, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. I shall be brief, but just on that SNIB question, should SNIB be investing in listed managed funds, does the panel think? And secondly, do the panel feel that the Citi deals that Tracy Black, you mentioned at the start in your opening responses, do Citi deals as a partnership and funding model, will they deliver low carbon infrastructure? Tracy Black, first of all, please.
I haven't had anybody talk to me about SNIB investing listed managed funds. It's not one I feel I've really got a proper response to, and I know that you are speaking to SFE and Phoenix and that afterwards, so they might be better placed to answer that question. On the Citi deals, I think they do play a very important role, and I say we have had members cite some examples. Aberdeen seems to be one of the most forward thinking on this, but like everything, I think it's that clear transparency of what is available to business. You know, over and over again, what we're hearing from our members is they don't know where to go, they don't know who to talk to, they don't know what's available, they don't, you know, and I think that's like that's a consistent theme, whether it's, so we're all very clear what the ambition for Scotland is, but actually delivering on that ambition, I think people are a lot more vague and it's quite hard work. So I would imagine there'll be certain enterprises that know exactly what's going on within the Citi deals. But I would imagine if you were to ask the vast majority of businesses across Scotland, they have very little visibility on what they could be doing with them or how they will affect them. Thank you.
Thank you. That's really interesting. Barry, do you have any thoughts on that?
So on your first point, Mr. Kerr, I'm not equipped to answer that. Wish I was, but I don't have anything to add. On the Citi deal point, however, I think we remain not entirely sold on the concept, and I think there are some good practices, particularly in the North East, and given the strong role that Opportunity North East provides for the private sector. But I think Citi region deals are very complex tripartite arrangements, which can be a little mystifying for lots of local businesses. And to answer your point about will it deliver low carbon investment, you know, they'll deliver what they were agreed to deliver back when the heads of terms were agreed, and those terms of agreement were agreed in quite a different era. And we have been pushing for some time for a reevaluation within the Citi deal space. You know, are the projects that we agreed, you know, going back to the Glasgow City Vision deal to now, the right ones? If they're not, how do we give local authorities and partnership, Scottish Government and UK Government, the space and creativity to change and adapt our projects? Because I think the world's changed, and what looked like a good project 4 years ago, five years ago, even 7 years ago is changed. So I think I think a lot of the local authorities have to be empowered to bring forward new projects using that investment that has been previously committed by the two governments.
Thanks very much. I'm very grateful for the answers. Second question, convener, if I may. I'll direct this to Tracy Black to begin with, and Barry again if you come in after if you have any further remarks. Tracy, you talked about household products and the cost of doing things differently earlier on. You might have heard prior to this session, we had a session on DRS and how important it could be in our net zero journey. Now, one of the concerns that this committee's heard is around the differing DRS systems between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, for example. Can you help the committee understand what does business think about that differing approach, and do you share those concerns?
You know, many of our members have come to us. So first and foremost, I think to be absolutely clear, business sees the idea of UK becoming a sort of leader in sustainability is a really good thing. And one of those key things is obviously using less and being more efficient with what we do use and reducing waste. So business, I think, is in full agreement with this ambition for Scotland and the rest of the UK become, you know, sort of world leaders at this. And the deposit return scheme is one of those methods to do so. So I think there is a general agreement and support for deposit return schemes, but there has to be an understanding that the vast majority of food and drink suppliers in the UK supply the UK, and that margins on food and drink products are usually incredibly tight. So therefore, having a standardised approach across the UK of, you know, what can be recycled, how it should be recycled, what materials, what products, it will really make or break the support of a system. So that is why people are going, these supply chains are really complex. It can often take not just months, but years for a company to change its supply chain, change the materials that it's using. So it takes time to plan. And if you ended up with a two-system approach, that just increases complexity and cost to the process. So what our members have said all along is that we support this, but can we have one system that works for the whole UK? I say what we're proposing is very, very ambitious. I can't remember who it was on the panel, but it was talking about, you know, we're going big scale here, different material, different products. This is fantastic. But what we want is everybody being able to deliver it in an affordable and an effective manner. And I think that is the big concern. And this is one of my points I said about is having different coloured recycling bins as well. If the whole of the UK had the same standardisation of bins, you know, Tesco's could put blue on every single piece of packaging that needs to go into that recycling bin. They could put black on everything else that has to go into landfill. We make it very confusing for the consumer to know what they can or cannot do. And I think it will be the same with the deposit return scheme. Let's keep it simple. Let's make sure everybody knows what they can and cannot do with it, whether you're, you know, supplying the process or, say, you're going to be using it. So there is no appetite for two different approaches.
Thank you. That's really interesting. Barry, do you have any further comments on that?
Yeah, I'll come in briefly, if that's okay. I think that in terms of our membership, you know, an independent retailer is likely to be pretty agnostic about whether or not the DRS scheme in Scotland is different from the one that might be created for the rest of the UK, because then they'll tend to be trading very local and very, very regional. I think that changes if you look at our members who are microbrewers who might want to sell their products across the UK, who, you know, they will be looking for at the very least compatibility. And I think we're at this point where the Scottish Government were first out of the blocks in developing their DRS scheme. And I think we're now at this point where how we get two separate yet entirely linked regulatory schemes to work together will be absolutely critical, particularly in regards to cross-border trade. But I think to go back to the previous committee's deliberation on DRS, it's all about, for FSB members, the practical, and it's all about how's this scheme going to impact me and what help do I have to mitigate some of those costs. And I think we would urge the decision makers and ministers and the Scottish and UK government to work together to arrive at a sensible compromise.
Very grateful to the panel. Back to you, convener.
Thanks very much, Liam. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm aware that we're running over time, so I'll just ask just the one question, convener, if that's helpful. In regards, you know, we're all saying that net zero will only work together, that businesses need to work together, local authorities need to work together. And as you know, I'm still a serving councillor for Aberdeen City Council. So I'm hearing in my role as an MSP and as a role as a councillor, I'm hearing from some businesses that sometimes there's little engagement from local authorities and that it's sometimes difficult to have an open, transparent conversation with them. So I would be interested to hear from the panel how they think that we can achieve true joint partnerships with local authorities and small businesses so that it's equal partnership, so that things are being done with each other rather than done to, if I'm making sense with that, convener. Can I go to Barry first and get his views on that, please?
Sure, absolutely. I was nodding vigorously in agreement there. Agree entirely about the importance of partnership working, particularly in the scope of net zero. And I think in many ways, the way that local authorities engage with small businesses on net zero is quite similar to the way they engage on other areas. And, you know, the engagement will be formed around a big idea or a lengthy policy document or a plan. It will be written in a fairly technical language that lots of business owners don't understand. The engagement might often arrive too late, or there's the idea certainly in the mind of it. Members that the local authority has already made up its mind, and I think there's good examples in and around that regarding spaces for people. But saying all that, there's lots of good practice, and there is, and I think it's important to highlight that we're not starting from scratch here. And, you know, I'd particularly emphasise the repeated attempts made by the likes of Aberdeen, Edinburgh and Glasgow City Councils to engage with FSB and other local businesses on their low emission zone plans, their city centre transformation work. So they are good building blocks here. How we use and activate those building blocks to make it as practically easy as possible for businesses to engage and shape is a big discussion that I think we'll be having post-election.
Thank you. Tracy, do you have anything to add?
Another angle to this is basically, you know, how can the private sector help the local authorities solve problems? And one of the key things business therefore needs to understand is, you know, one, what is the problem that local authority is trying to solve, whether it's around transport, pollution, waste, etc. And they also need, you know, the details. So something that we don't talk about nearly enough is data. One of the key things I think in a partnership is that if the local authorities can provide those data sets. So if we look at transport, you know, do they know who's on the roads? Do they know where those people come from, where they're going to? You know, and that can, whether that is their public transport with smart ticketing, obviously gives you a lot of information, or if it is your vans or your cars, you know, did they start their day in that vehicle or did they come somewhere else? It's the same with in housing. You know, do they know how many houses need retrofitted? Do they know what streets they're on? Do they have a priority for who lives in those houses, whether it's pensioners or people who have young families or benefits? If local authorities can start providing those data sets, that's one thing, but it's also what do you do with that data? Who do you share that with? So if we look at countries like Singapore, have made whole sets of data sets available, not just for net zero, but to solve many challenges. That's when you attract the innovators. So they've had some really smart traffic apps, for example, developed because the developers could be in South Korea, they could be in London, they could be in Edinburgh, going, oh, look, there's an opportunity there. I can identify what the problem is they want solved. They're providing me with the data to give me the insights so I can build something. And we often underlook that if we don't know what it is, the size of the problem or the scale of the problem, we can't do it. And I think Scotland, for a small country, has been very slow at getting that type of data out. And it can cross housing, it can cross skills, it can cross transport. that is something very, very powerful, that if we got there, you could see real partnership with private sector coming with that innovation, solve some of these massive problems. Because, you know, we must look at the, what are the things that are really going to shift the dial? And that is going to be things around heat on scale, transport on scale. And we must focus on, with the urgency of climate change, we've got to really be identifying the projects that are going to have a meaningful impact overall for the country. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And back to you, Convener. As I said, just one very quick question from me today.
That's great, Jackie. Thanks very much. Appreciate it. Final question from Natalie Dawn. Natalie, I'll hand over to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to the panel. This has been very informative today. Again, just a quick question. So we've talked a lot this morning about partnership work in local authorities and following up on my colleague's question. It's just to get your views on some of the partnership mechanisms highlighted in the the updated climate change plan. But this could be, for example, Grangemouth Future Industry Board within my constituency, National Manufacturing Institute of Scotland, or Dundee's Mitchell and Scotland Innovation Park. I would assume, as I say, given the tone of this morning, you would be quite positive around that. But yeah, if you could give me your views on that, and I'll maybe go to Barry first, if that's okay.
I think there's perennial challenges, irrespective of the topic or the partnership arrangements, to get meaningful engagement from local businesses. You know, they're busy running their businesses. They don't have the time or resources to get involved in these discussions. And I think that whilst representative bodies like FSB and Chambers of Commerce and CBI and others, you know, do their bit, I think there's a need, certainly moving forward, to try and make things as simple, straightforward and actionable as possible. And, you know, we use this language, you know, I'm guilty of it, we're all guilty of it, around, you know, net zero and just transition. And all I would say is that, you know, that language is not widely understood by most business owners or households across the country. And so I think as we move forward, just try and keep things, I think the partnership arrangements that keep things simple and focus on one or two things, maybe starting small and then building up that momentum can be a fine force for change. But I think that some of the regional partnerships that have morphed out of the city region deals arrangements have become far too complex and complicated because they need to be for the reviews, for the spend. But I think there's a big discussion about how you can encourage and facilitate greater engagement in these important partnerships for local businesses who are directly impacted by the decisions.
Barry?
Yeah, look, carry on.
No, I was just going to say, if you've got anything to add on, you go. Thank you.
Look, I think you've given really good examples. You know, what has been done at the Michelin site is fantastic. Obviously, the advanced manufacturing, you know, amazing. I think I would just keep coming back that, you know, this challenge that net zero is, you know, is a global challenge that is enormous. And while we have this local focus, which is critical, I think any initiatives we're doing, we just need to be open to partners that could be from anywhere. And I think, you know, it's how do you get that ask out wider, whether it's across the whole of Scotland or the whole of UK. I think we can't be too siloed on this or too parochial. I think the task at hand is huge. There is no real solution for retrofitting old buildings to the standard we want to get them. It just doesn't really exist. And, you know, that is just in itself, you know, our domestic buildings account for, you know, what is it, 40% or something of our emissions. It is enormous and the technology isn't there. So all I would say is I think, you know, partnerships are fantastic. They do work when they're done well. But at the moment, the challenge for what I'm hearing across my membership is it's pretty localized. So businesses in that community who are experts and it might know about it, but as soon as you try and widen that out a bit, probably have no clue. Like if you were to speak to businesses in Edinburgh, I bet they don't know anything about Michelin. And even a whole host of manufacturers across Scotland probably don't know about the manufacturing. So it's how do we just really set out our stall of what's available, what's the opportunity, and it really shouldn't be a postcode sort of lottery. We've actually seen that. There was a couple of great opportunities that were being put out by Aberdeen City Council, but it wasn't available to businesses in Aberdeenshire. And I just sort of think, you know, if it's a good scheme, it should be available to any business wherever they are. So I think that's our problem at the moment, is this problem is so huge, we need to be really open to where that support or that innovation or that investment comes from, and not to be worried about where the brass plate is.
Okay, thank you both. Back to convener.
Thanks very much, Natalie. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. So let me thank Tracy and Barry. Thanks very much for joining the committee this morning, sharing your expertise and your insights across a number of hugely important areas. It is very much appreciated. Thank you very much. And I will now briefly suspend this meeting to allow for a change of panel. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. I now welcome our second panel this morning, comprising representatives from the finance sector. We have with us Sandy Begbie, CBE, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Financial Enterprise, Jeremy Lawson, Chief Economist and Head of Climate Scenario Analysis, Aberdeen, and Tim Lord, Head of Climate Change, Phoenix Group. Thank you very much for joining us today. Apologies, we're running slightly behind schedule. For this panel session, we have just about an hour, and we will move straight to questions. And let me start with the first question. As you will be aware, the Glasgow Financial Alliance Network announced during COP26 highlighted the unprecedented scale of private capital potentially available for net zero investment. And when we took evidence from a range of local authority leaders a few weeks ago, there was recognition that many local authority projects will have to almost entirely be funded by private sector capital. If you take the heat and buildings strategy as an example, the numbers are massive, involving tens of billions of pounds of capital investment over the next 5 to 8 years. So I have a couple of questions for the panel. What needs to happen in practice to channel this unprecedented level of private capital into these public sector projects? Is there sufficient scale of investment opportunity within each of the 32 local authority areas to attract this capital? Do we have the right institutions in place to facilitate this public-private partnership? And what do local authorities and indeed the Scottish Government need to do now to start accelerating this movement of capital? And panel members are more than welcome to, you know, not answer every single question, to pick up the issues they want to focus on most. And perhaps, Sandy, I could start with you, then move to Jeremy and Tim. So, Sandy, I'll pass over to you at this stage.
Many thanks, convener, and good morning, everyone. As I said, there's a lot in that question. I'll probably maybe focus on 4 or 5 key points I think that are really important to make that happen. I think one is, and it's a word that's used a lot these days, is around collaboration and ways of working. I think that in order to deliver against the commitments and timescales we're working towards, I think both private and public sector are going to have to work in a way that I think, if we're honest with each other, then has been pretty challenging in the past. I think that level of collaboration is going to be at a scale that we've not seen before. And that's because of, I think, that we need to think about scale and pace. As you've rightly pointed out, there are significant amounts of significant challenges that we face, and the ability to look at these at scale and how do we address these issues at pace, I think, is something that we all need to come to the table with, and recognising that at times we will need to look across some of these local authority boundaries that we have in order to develop those scale business cases that the private sector would want to look at. And then I think the third point I would say is around investable business cases. As you've rightly pointed out, I think I think one of the positive things that we have, it came through at COP26, is that capital and available capital is not the issue here. There is plenty of capital globally in order to fund these. It's about making sure that the investable business cases are there and connecting that public and private sector together. And finally, I would talk about is innovation. I think we're going to have to be quite innovative about how we look at some of the products that will connect to the capital pools with the needs that we have. And if we take home insulation as a good example, I think, as mentioned previously, you know, things like, there are plenty of capital available for things like wind farms and other things, but actually what we're talking here is about retrofitting, you know, the majority of the private households in Scotland, and doing it quickly. And in order to do that, we're going to have to think quite innovatively about how we connect that capital with that need. And I think we also need to look at this very much from an inclusion lens. So there's going to be 20-25% of citizens in Scotland who, even if they wanted to and understood it, probably don't have the means to do it. So we're going to have to think about how does the financial sector, together with the public sector, think creatively around how do we make sure that this is affordable to everyone, because there's no point in getting to 2030 and having a large portion of the public unable to make that transition. And I think we need to look at some pilots that are happening elsewhere in the world, like, for example, in Italy, where they are trying to connect that public and private sector together in a way that's quite different to what's happened in the past. So I would say collaboration at a level we've not necessarily seen before, scale and pace I think is going to be really important. I think making sure that the projects are investable and that they're put together in that way. And finally, innovation. I think for me, those are the things that are going to be really important.
Thanks very much, Sandy. A lot of issues there that we will follow up with. Let me put the same question to Jeremy and then Tim. So Jeremy, over to you, please.
Okay, thank you, and thanks everybody for having me today. If it's okay, I might sort of actually go back a step. And what I mean by that is, I think it's really important to frame the problem or the challenge in the right way. And that is just, we have to absolutely recognize that climate change is itself a result of an enormous market failure, right? And what I mean by that is excess emissions, they represent an externality, right? So they're a cost to society, they're a cost to the environment, ultimately in the long run, a cost to the economy that is not fully factored into the decision-making of those that create the emissions, right? And so immediately there, you sort of recognize an intersection between the public and the private sector, because one of the most fundamental responsibilities of the public sector is to set policy in a way that forces the private sector to internalize that external cost, right? And that can be done in a few ways. One of those is clearly through the mechanism of carbon pricing, right? Up until the UK left the European Union, it was part of the emissions trading scheme. The UK is obviously establishing an emissions sort of trading scheme. It will be absolutely essential that the UK's emission trading scheme has a carbon budget and pricing that is completely consistent with those net zero 2050 objectives, because if there's any wedge there, one of the most important mechanisms for achieving this, it won't exist. Building on that, I'm sure some of the committee members are aware that there are proposals, although they will be controversial and we'll see what happens, to expand the EU ETS to cover the buildings and the transportation sector in a way that isn't currently the case at the moment. Now, that will likely occur through bringing in the upstream producers of those emissions into the scheme, not by bringing households, for example, into the emissions sort of trading scheme. But nonetheless, there's a recognition that because the costs of the energy transition, or the challenges in the transition in the building sector in particular, but also the transportation sector, are arguably even more significant than the power sector. If you don't bring those two sectors within your pricing mechanism, you make the transition more difficult. And of course, price signals are an absolutely phenomenal way of incentivizing changes in private sector activity and investment, right? Now, there may be circumstances and reasons why that pricing can't be extended in all the areas that it needs to. And in those cases, it's important that regulation be aligned with those same goals, and arguably effectively replicating the cost that would otherwise happen through an emissions sort of trading scheme. So, for example, vehicle emission sort of standards or other sort of types of regulations, they have to be designed in a way to generate that same pathway. So I think that's absolutely foundational here, because, you know, the question that you raised about the availability of private sector finance. So yes, there are large pools of capital that are ready to aid the transition, but they will not generate that transition on their own, right, if policy settings aren't also aligned with those goals. In fact, if you look at a lot of asset owners and asset managers and their commitments around the net zero transition, whether that be in the UK, in Europe, and even more so globally, almost all have some fine print in those commitments, right, which say, we will provide the capital and reorient our organizations to aid the transition as long as global policymakers do the right thing. So there is a circularity to these sort of commitments that has to be recognized, because financial flows will not align with net zero if there aren't mechanisms to force it. So that's one really important point. I think a second one, and this sort of relates to it, is a lot of this is a lot of the private sector investment, at least in our view and the way that our company is sort of Aberdeen is sort of structured, is likely to sort of to come forth through the non-recourse sort of project financing, right? These sort of things. This is something that Aberdeen is very closely involved in a number of public-private sector partnerships around infrastructure, concessionary sort of infrastructure, where there is actually sort of close relationships between the providers of the finance, the maintainers of the facilities, and the public sector. But when it comes to infrastructure projects that have to be aligned with net zero goals, there needs to be a recognition that in many cases, the economic case for that investment is not strong enough on its own to generate enough of that financing, right? Without that financing gap that almost sort of, again, represents that externality, that cost that needs to be overcome and ultimately absorbed by the private sector. Now, the size of that externality, so the size of the financing gap will vary from project to project, but that again sort of underpins the importance of public-private sector partnership, because in many cases, the public sector will need to take that portion of the risk or what is it effectively a subsidy to bring forth the optimal amount of private sector investment to crowd it in to those projects. Without that, you'll get a suboptimal amount of investment. And in, again, in these sort of sectors where you don't have a formal carbon budget that sort of effectively generates or guarantees a particular outcome, then you run the risk of emissions not declining as rapidly as they need to, particularly in these sectors where the cost of abatement is particularly high. And then one final point about sort of scale, because I think this has been mentioned and it is very important. One of the barriers to investment is that, I mean, let's be honest, a lot of the investment that is needed is what we might describe as micro investment, right? Certainly when it comes to the housing sort of sector, but also some elements of transportation as well. It's not the role of the private sector to sort of to talk about what's the optimal way of building local government institutions, but I think that there will be a need to look at pooling mechanisms, right, to ensure that the scale problem can be overcome. And for example, there may be options around, particularly when it comes to debt, around securitization. Now, securitization can be a dirty word in some circles, but it is a way of sort of scaling pools of finance across a wider range of assets and a wider range of, you know, of geographies in circumstances where it would otherwise sort of be very localized. And then finally, I think that there are mechanisms where this is probably less for institutional capital, but one of the things that I was involved in the past was, and to be transparent about all of this, I worked as a policy advisor to the then leader of the opposition in Australia, Kevin Rudd, in the run-up to the 2007 election. So I was his climate policy advisor. And now I don't need to tell you what a disaster climate policy has been in Australia over the subsequent sort of 15 years. But one of the things that we recognised early on was around this retrofitting problem, right? Was that, again, why are households not incentivized to retrofit in the way that is necessary for that sector to decarbonize in line with a net zero or any other sort of particular transition? And that's because, you know, the payoff, right, the payoff structure and the implicit cost that they have to absorb, you know, aren't sort of fully rewarded. So there is this externality again that you need to encourage them to internalize. Now, rather than penalising them, the better way to do that might be, for example, to provide sort of subsidised loans to individual households. So, you know, again, you identify how much retrofitting would occur in the absence of that loan subsidisation. How much do you need to occur? And then you provide the financing gap in order to help them sort of meet that need. And so we designed a policy at the time, which then after there were changes in government sort of were lost. But you know, there are ways to design policy in order to bring that forward. So that's not likely to be something that a large institutional investor like ourselves gets directly involved in. But sort of speaking as a policy expert in these areas, being creative with these mechanisms and how you might internalize these costs and generate more rapid decarbonization is essential.
Okay, Jeremy, you touched on a number of really interesting points there, and I'm sure we'll want to come back to you to look at them in more detail. Let me bring in Tim Lord. Same sort of initial questions I had for the other panel members. Tim, I believe that the Phoenix Group have in the past been involved in some, you know, private sector, public sector investments in social housing. So I'm not sure if you want to touch on that or if you want to address some other issues, but I'll pass over to you to address the same question.
Thank you, Convener, and it's a pleasure to be here today. And Phoenix is the UK's biggest long-term savings retirement business. We have about $300 billion in assets under management, and we're a purpose-driven organisation. So, you know, we see the scale of the investment challenge in Scotland and across the UK, but we also think, obviously, we have a really significant role to play in addressing that, including, and I'll touch on it, in the social housing sector, as you say. But to get back to your original question, kind of, you know, what needs to happen, I think there's sort of three things that I would identify in terms of the challenge that we have here. The first is around opportunities. So I think, as others have said, the issue here is not so much a lack of available capital. The issue is more a lack of a pipeline of investable projects. That varies across different sectors. In some areas, that pipeline is much more developed, but in others, less so. I mean, the second issue is around the complexity the investment process. So very often, in particular, as we get out of large scale centralized power generation and into things like investment in buildings, in communities and cities and regions across the country, often those are very complex, fragmented projects. There's quite often a lack of comparable data, which you touched on, I think, in the previous session as well. So there's a big challenge there. And I think the third is the fundamental one, which is around the financial attractiveness of those opportunities. Because clearly, you know, we're a purpose-driven organisation. We have ambitious net zero targets. We're, of course, not alone in that. I think the sector more widely is setting ambitious targets. But we also have fiduciary duties to our customers, to our investors, to make sure that we're getting appropriate returns. So making sure that that's in place. And I think, you know, no doubt we'll unpack many things that we can do to address that in this session. I think I very briefly identify five. The first is around policy certainty and investment frameworks. And policy certainty doesn't mean that we need to say this is exactly how we're going to get to net zero in 2045 in Scotland, 2050 in the UK, and this is exactly how many gigawatts of each technology and how many heat pumps we need. But it is about making sure that we have investable frameworks that private capital can come in behind. And we've seen the effectiveness and the success of that in the renewable sector, where obviously Scotland has achieved, you know, genuinely world-leading deployment of renewables. We saw the outcome of the auction last week. We have a really strong project pipeline, and we have in the Contract for Difference an investable instrument. The challenge is about how we then replicate that approach across different sectors. The second challenge, I think, is about thinking this in a systemic way rather than simply a sectoral way. Traditionally, when we've done decarbonisation, we've thought about houses and we've thought about cars and we've thought about power generation and we've thought about industry. The next phase of this is not going to look like that, because all those sectors are going to interact, as you know, our electricity system provides energy, not just for our lights and so on, but for our cars and for our heat pumps and all those kinds of things. And those systemic issues are happening across this transition. And actually, local authorities are superbly well placed to play a huge role in that, because that is where this change happens. It's about local energy systems. It's about local economic systems. And I think thinking about these things in a systemic way is going to be hugely important. I think the third is around collaboration. And again, you've touched on this, so I won't labour the point. But collaboration, in particular, across boundaries, because very often the kinds of systems that we're talking about here, the kinds of projects that we might be talking about here, are not necessarily limited to a single local authority area. They will often cross boundaries, or there will be synergies with activities in other areas. So making sure that we're exploiting that. The fourth is around skills, which again is often talked about. And I think skills in two respects. One, around local authorities' ability to package those financial opportunities in an effective way. And I don't mean that pejoratively. It's not an easy thing to do. They're hugely resource constrained. And I think there are examples of good practice, not just in Scotland, but in other parts of the UK. But at the moment, they're relatively isolated. So how do we upskill local authorities to be able to package those opportunities in an attractive way and have the skills to do that is critically important. And then the last point is that about how do we bring projects together to a scale that makes them more attractive to, in particular, large institutional investors. One of the challenges here, you know, we are talking about buildings, we're talking about, you know, charges on individual streets, and often we are talking about smaller scale projects. How can we package those together at a larger scale, and making sure that we're using the role of public finance, public sector finance, which I don't think should be taking the majority of the load here, but I think can have a hugely important role in de-risking some of these projects and making them more attractive.
Tim, thank you very much. Let me follow up by kind of bringing this Next question, but back to the sort of main focus of the inquiry, which is, you know, what can local authorities do? What additional support do they need? Because I think Sandy made the point, we're not looking at private investors, private capital, cherry picking the most attractive assets here. When you look at hidden buildings, it's not 50% that need to be done. It's pretty much 100% the most attractive assets, as well as some of the more challenging assets. It strikes me there are, based on the three responses, a number of threshold issues that need to be addressed, a number of kind of almost structural issues to get to unlock the private capital going into public sector projects. One is the point about data, identifying the hundreds of thousands of assets, be they tenements, be they public sector buildings, identifying those assets and having the data available so that they can be packaged up into investment projects to attract private capital. So that's the one issue, data. Second issue is scale. I think obviously Scotland has 32 local authorities of different sizes. When we had the leaders of Glasgow, Edinburgh and Aberdeen, the three largest local authorities in Scotland, even they were saying that, you know, a city the size of Glasgow might not be able to package together on its own a sufficient scale of assets, let alone some of the smaller local authorities. And then, Sandy, you mentioned the innovation, and Tim and Jeremy, you spoke about securitisation and developing new markets. Are we looking at the need to develop a new market here, a new type of financial product? In the US, you have the municipal bond markets, which have a long history. We don't really have that level of historic municipal bond financing in the UK or in Scotland. That's obviously going to take a lot of time to develop as well, because not all of these financings will happen at the same time. You'll have some pathway investments to hopefully set the standard to test out market interest and private capital interest in some of these projects. So part of my question here is, and you have helped to identify some of these threshold structural issues, do local authorities have, in your experience, the necessary capacity and expertise to manage all of this? If not, across Scotland and even in the UK, do we have the right institutions in place that can help to address some of these structural issues? What role, for example, can the Scottish National Investment Bank play in all of this? And Jeremy, going to your point, what regulatory change or changes will be required in order to unlock private capital to help fund a lot of these public sector assets? And apologies, a whole range of issues there, but trying to bring into play some of the issues each of you have identified in your opening statements. So Sandy, maybe I can address this to you. Again, you can pick up whatever of those issues you think are more pressing, and then I'll bring in Tim and Jeremy. Over to you, Sandy.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, convener. Just picking up some of the points. I think if I take the first one around scale, I think in Scotland, I think the city deal model is potentially one that's worthwhile looking at. I think that, you know, if you're looking at if you take Edinburgh City Deal, which covers West Lothian, Mid Lothian, East Lothian, Fife, etc., then I do think there's a need for the chief executives of councils to come together to really look at how do you package that together at scale. There's various ways you could cut that, but I think, as you've already pointed out, you know, even the leaders of the some of the largest cities are themselves even thinking about how do you develop that into those scalable propositions. I think secondly is this point about innovation, and I mentioned earlier just about, for example, a scheme in Italy, and I'm not suggesting this is the right answer, but it's just to give you an idea of what's been tested, where, for example, in Italy, whereby the cost of the retrofit on homes isn't borne by the owner, it's added to the property, and at some point in the future, then the equity that is built up on that property would then be released in some mechanism. That would allow long-term funders to invest for 15, 20 years, particularly in that pension space, pension firm space. It's underpinned by a guarantee from government around, you know, making up good any loss, but ultimately the repayment of that is built into the future inflation that would kick in terms of the value of the property. So I'm not saying that's the right answer, but I'm just giving you an idea of actually there needs to be bringing together of public and private to really look at what are significant challenges that require significant amounts of money. I think you referenced about the infrastructure that we have in Scotland. I think one of our strengths is the strength of our financial services and professional services industry. And maybe some people say you would say that given your role, but if you think about what we've got, we have every aspect of financial services here in Scotland, and quite often at scale, and we've got a very very strong professional services. And you asked specifically about SNIB, and I think that its launch during a pandemic, everything else, it's created some challenges. Some really good examples of some of the investments have already made in line with their purpose. I think the challenge is how do we get SNIB plugged into that infrastructure, and making sure that we connect all those components together. But we are working on that directly with SNIB as we speak, and they're part of the new government engagement group that we set up with the industry that was launched last week. And then finally, regulation. I think we've had some of our members, we've engaged directly with Bank of England, through some of our members, around some of the regulation barriers that may exist, and that I think that it's important that SFE and our members can engage all parties on thinking about how do we present a coherent position on some of the changes that we think may well be necessary, and some of the things that are important, particularly around about some of the Solvency II changes and others. So I think that summary scale, I think we do need to look across those traditional boundaries. I think secondly, I think innovation is going to be important, and I think we do need to all parties need to be open to that. I think third is, I do think we've got the infrastructure, we just need to make sure it's all aligned and pointed in the right direction. And fourth is around about regulation. I think that we do need to, through collaboration, public and private, be prepared to go to the regulator with some of the things that we think are important in order to make this transition happen.
Thanks very much, Sandy. And Tim, let me put some of these issues to you, and also maybe an additional question about timing. There seems to be quite a lot that needs to be done here, and not all of it can be done, you know, in parallel. So some of it has to be done sequentially. We've got a target of, you know, I think in Scotland 2030 to retrofit domestic dwellings as well as non-domestic dwellings. Presumably, all of this is going to take some time. So Tim, I'll ask you to address some of these issues if that's okay with you.
Yeah, sure. I'll, as you say, there's a lot to unpack in there, and I'll try and cover a few of the questions that you asked. I think the first thing I'd say, and it links to your point about timing, is the data question and the understanding of systems question is absolutely critically important here. And by data, I don't just mean, you know, if there's a 1,000 houses that we want to build in an energy efficient, low carbon way, here's how we can kind of package up the data about what that will achieve in terms of carbon. What I mean is, if you look at a city like, you know, Edinburgh or Glasgow or Aberdeen, what actually does the decarbonisation journey for that city look like? What investment is needed to make that happen, and how should that investment be sequenced? Because while net zero is complex, in some ways it's not all that complex. You know, we're pretty sure that we're going down an EV route, so you're pretty sure what you need in terms of electric vehicle infrastructure. Where we have perhaps less clarity is around the housing stock and the building stock, and what does decarbonising the heating of that look like? And I sort of pick up on a point made in the previous session where I think the technologies do exist actually. In many cases, they're too expensive, and one of the reasons they're too expensive is because they're not being delivered at scale, and local supply chains can't accommodate the demand that's coming. If you look at, you know, I've heard quotes of sort of £1,000 a day to get a heat pump installed, whereas you're talking about probably more like £150 or £200 for labour to get a boiler replaced, and all of those kinds of issues. And data is at the heart of that. What actually does the decarbonisation pathway look like for these cities? Because then you can start, the innovators will then start being able to package up some of those opportunities. I mean, the second thing is, you know, you asked about the kind of financial products that we need here. Local authorities have a huge role to play, that they cannot do it on their own, in the sense that, you know, the clarity of investment frameworks, the point that I made before, you have seen, you know, a huge flow of investment into renewables because the investment framework is there. And there were some relatively novel products made to do that, but fundamentally, you know, once the contract for difference was there, finance could come in behind that. You don't see those investable propositions. You know, if I think about myself getting a heat pump in my house that I'm sitting in here now, it'll cost me more than a high carbon alternative, and it'll increase my bills because of the way that we structure bills in the UK at the moment. Now that has to change. It doesn't really matter what local authorities do if they're facing barriers like that. If you look at much larger scale at things like CCS, I think there's a lot of reasons why we haven't seen the CCS investment that we're clearly going to need in order to hit net zero. But the fundamental problem is that it is not currently an investable proposition at scale. Local authorities need the Scottish Government, they need the Westminster Government to do a lot in order to design the frameworks that can enable that that investment to flow. I think in terms of institutions, I'm always cautious about sort of, you know, thinking we need to rip up institutions in particular to deliver something. Say we need to do at real pace in the next 30 years. Having said that, I think there is probably some institutional space for the kind of convening and packaging these kinds of opportunities. Before I was at Phoenix Group a couple of years ago, I spent a lot of time in central government in Westminster. One of the projects that we were working on was in Teesside in the northeast of England. And of course, that started with a very, very fragmented set of propositions. And what's happened there is that has been packaged together into what looks like a kind of overall economic transformation for the region, which crosses a number of local authority boundaries. And I guess the question for me is, institutionally, do we have the capability in Scotland and in many other parts of the UK, including the rest of England, to bring together those kinds of transformational economic decarbonisation opportunities? And that, to me, feels like where the institutional gap is.
Okay, Tim, thanks very much. Jeremy, I'm conscious I've not brought you in here, but I'm very keen to bring other members in. So I'll hand over at this stage to Fiona Hislop, and I'm sure Fiona will want to bring you in on her question. So Fiona, over to you, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and I'm glad you could all join us and to share a very valuable insight. I'm going to ask you separate questions, if that's okay, and to pursue some of the points that you've already made. The Scottish Government has established a Green Finance Task Force, so it's just being started. So therefore, your prospectus of what it should cover would be helpful. For Jeremy first, can I come to you? And it's about this idea of aggregating investable propositions. I very much appreciated your wider concept and framework, but from an aggregate side, what does that look like? The Scottish Government's established a £3 billion green investment portfolio, but even that is challenging and has subsets. So what size of investment would your investment colleagues think would be worth coming to the table for?
I think it varies by project. I don't want to give the impression that every project that an institutional investor wants to consider must be a mega project, right? But if you sort of think about it as the smaller the scale, right? Each project needs a certain amount of consideration and resources that are devoted to it, you know, to make a sort of a consideration, right? Effectively there's almost like a, think of that as a fixed cost sort of going through a process of evaluation. And so the ratio of that fixed cost, right, to your return rises the smaller the project, whereas with a larger project that cost can sort of be spread over, a larger sort of return sort of stream, and so it can be absorbed more easily. I mean, I guess what I'm driving at most of all, is just simply the idea of that there need to be pooling mechanisms. And I think one of the other sort of speakers mentioned this. So take the need for charging sort of stations, right? If you think about that too locally, right, you just won't take advantage of the enormous sort of potential economies of scope and sort of scale that a large scale installation sort of regime might capture, and therefore be also more attractive to bringing in private or crowding in private sector capital. And then equally, right, and as I think is very clear, that type of infrastructure has a large public good element to it. I think we would recognise that, right? I mean, it's to the public good represents that part of the sort of the subsidy that the public sector on some level is going to have to absorb to make sure that that architecture, that infrastructure, is sufficiently large, right, to generate the sort of the scale of the investment that is, you know, that is necessary. If you leave it to the private sector, you'll get less charging infrastructure ultimately than is optimal to achieve the other part of the platform, which is the transformation of the vehicle stock, and not just the passenger vehicle stock, because there are then these big technology questions about what happens to larger heavy haul road transportation over time as well, right? Where those sort of costs of the net zero transition may be sort of significantly larger, and the technological sort of barriers haven't been overcome yet. And then when it comes to retrofitting, well, ultimately you're going to need a different set of solutions for that than you are for charging, you know, charging infrastructure. You know, I think because it's sort of it's largely going to have to be done at the through households or small asset owner decision making. And I think what sort of Sandy said beforehand is, you know, that was sort of one mechanism. You could also focus on the on relieving the borrowing constraints for individual households. But one way or another, you have to come up with more creative sort of financing mechanisms. So you sort of talked about these institutions that are developing, or, you know, this was part of the question sort of beforehand as well. We may have the constituent parts in local government, right, national government, financial institutions, but in my experience, what we really lack is a pooling mechanism for expertise, right, where these sort of groups can work together on deeper sort of finer grain sort of problems, and are incentivized to do so. It's very easy to set up talking shops. It's much more difficult to set up sort of new coordinating mechanisms that solve the problem. And given the speed with which the Scottish Government is trying to achieve some of its aims, there really is no time to wait to put those in place, because the absence of it will then sort of continue to mean that actually sort of emissions decline, but emissions decline more slowly than the overall goals sort of require. And so then that gap will sort of get larger and larger over time.
Thank you. And if I can come to Tim now, I was very interested in what you said about looking at this from a systems point of view, not just looking at it separate kind of sectors. Heat and buildings and councils basically are a lot of our focus of our interest. But your point about maybe looking at this from a kind of energy production, distribution, as well as use within the house, and looking at a package around that is an interesting one. Is that the area you're thinking about? And secondly, because I'm conscious of time, could you also talk about pensions and pension fund investment, and maybe people looking at, you know, the fact that local authority pension funds could and should be investing in this area, and what needs to change to help encourage that? And is there a danger that the easier option is for carbon offsetting and natural capital investment, as opposed to being part of that partnership for decarbonisation? So, Tim, could you maybe address those points, please?
Yeah, sure. I'll try to be brief. I think on your question about systems, the challenge for me is, what do we all need to do in our local community? We're all going to need better electricity infrastructure, because we're going to be putting a lot more load on the electricity system. We're going to need energy efficiency rolled out across the housing stock. And there's a question about how you do that most efficiently. Is it best for me to just make that decision at the right time, and for my next door neighbour to do it 8 years later, and the person over the road to do it 8 years after that? Or for us to do it in a more coherent way, if we're able and willing to do that. We need to transition our heating systems. That'll, you know, be pretty heavily dependent, in my view, on heat pumps, but heat networks, in particular in Scottish cities, have a big role to play. We're going to need a lot more chargers for electric vehicles. And we're also going to need to shape those different systems according to local capabilities. You know, if somewhere is near a hydrogen production facility, then maybe it will be that hydrogen is suitable for heating in that area, for example. But the challenge at the moment is that we've got some fantastic pathways from the CCC at UK level, at Scotland level, but we don't really have the translation of that into what does it mean in my neighbours, in my local authority area. And the consequence of that is that you don't have the packaging of those opportunities for investors to get in behind in a straightforward way. Now, that isn't to say that it isn't happening already. It also isn't to say, I think as Jeremy mentioned, that in some cases, you know, smaller propositions can work. You know, we're funding some projects of, say, about 1,000 houses. But the more you can package those together, given the scale of the opportunity, and the more you can do it in a systemic way, so we're thinking about energy efficiency and heat together, rather than sort of, you know, getting everyone to install a bunch of energy efficiency and then coming back 5 years later and knocking on the door and saying, sorry, you've got to get a heat pump now as well. But you could have done that at one time. You could have packaged that together for a larger investment proposition. That seems to me that has to be the right way to go. And I don't think we have that data and capability yet. On your question about pensions, I mean, you know, my view is in some senses, and I probably would say this given being a Phoenix, but it's the kind of great untapped resource in the sense that pensions investment is generally long-term and pretty patient. A lot of these investments are, you know, long-term systemic changes rather than, you know, looking for very, very high short-term returns without an eye to the medium and the longer term. So I think, you know, there's various things that the regulators can do to help start incentivizing that even more than they are, although I think we've made a lot of progress on that in the last two or three years. I think the other point which is important is around kind of the public's understanding of this. Because I think, you know, do people understand the impact that their pension has on emissions? No, they don't, in the vast majority of cases. In many cases, they don't even really understand that their pension is invested in anything. And I think the kind of information around that is absolutely incumbent on the pension sector to do that. I think also there's a much wider public information and public understanding challenge for politicians and for ministers at all different levels of government. To really be made to explaining to people, yes, you're concerned about climate change, but this is where your carbon footprint occurs. These are the things you can do to influence it. Because I think actually that consumer pull will be hugely important in driving change at the kind of pace that we need.
I can just address the issue. Is it easier to do offsetting than actually be part of the decarbonisation agenda for pension funds and their trustees?
Sorry, yeah. So my view is, you know, I was in the Westminster government when we moved from an 80% target to a net zero target. The interesting thing for me was that I discovered what I'd always suspected, which was that everyone thought they were in the 20%. So you're on a net zero target, everyone's in, and everyone understands that all sectors of the economy need to decarbonize. There is clearly then the next challenge, which is what does net mean? And what net means is, you know, we get rid of all emissions apart from the essential ones and we offset the remainder. The challenge is what's an essential emission? You get different answers to that question if you ask different people. I think what's incumbent on you know, whether it's pension funds or any other part of the economy is to deliver genuine emission reduction rapidly where you can. Clearly offsetting, and in particular high quality offsetting and use of nature-based solutions has a role in that, but I think the challenge for us, as it is for others, is about how we absolutely minimize that role and we deliver genuine emission reduction and credible emission reduction. And then where there is a need for offsetting, which hopefully will reduce over time, as we get closer to 2050, as technologies develop, which enable more and more emissions to be cut at source, but that we're investing in offsetting, which has a positive impact on communities, which is genuinely sustainable and which is appropriately priced.
Can I chip in on that question? Is that okay? Because I think just on this offsetting point, part of the problem is that particularly in the voluntary market, the costs of offsets are incredibly cheap, right? Mm. So one of the things that attracts investors, potentially in individual corporations, to go down that pathway is because they can achieve a given sort of emission reduction sort of pathway at a much sort of lower cost. Now, long term, that's not really viable. It sort of reflects the fact that a lot of these offsetting projects are sort of like low hanging fruit that are being plucked at the moment where there's very cheap abatement options. But as this sort of activity scales up, the cost of that will increase substantially, but also the what you might call regulatory failures in the offsetting sort of space that sort of mean that actually some of this offsetting isn't sort of truly additive and therefore making the necessary contribution. So I think this is, there's a lot of activity around COP and the Article 6 process And so I think a lot of need for significant institutional improvements and regulatory tightening around these offsetting and natural sort of, you know, natural sort of capital and nature-based sort of solutions markets, you know, to ensure that exactly as you're saying, you don't end up with an inefficient allocation of capital through these channels just because it creates the appearance of cheaper abatement options for companies that are trying or sort of institutions that are trying to achieve it.
Thanks very much. And I'm conscious of time. If I can come to Sandy Begbie, and you were talking about equity release packages and products potentially for this. Now, clearly in the private sector, you could perhaps see a mortgage modification kind of product. But in the public sector, and we're looking at local authorities and you're looking at securitization of assets, are you therefore looking at some kind of, dare I say, private sector share in public owned stock? And that obviously would be a massive change for many local authorities. But is there a kind of risk-based approach on this on a city deal basis that you see as a potential solution? So, Sandy, any comments on that and anything you want to add on pensions? And then after that, I'll hand back to the convener. Sandy Begbie, please.
Yeah, thank you. I think just to pick up point pensions, because I think these are linked. I think in terms of already touched on this, you know, pension funds are arguably one of the untapped you know, potentials that we've got in this space. They are looking for long-term investments, it's patient capital, they're looking for steady returns, they're looking to balance, you know, manage their asset and liability profile over 10, 15, 20 years. So it's a natural place to look at for that type of investment. I think the on the public housing stock, I think it would require something like that. I think I think there's been various numbers quoted around the amount of private sector money that's going to be needed to help with the transition, and obviously it will depend on what area. But you know, we, at COP26, so we're talking about upwards of 80-85% of the money that's going to be required across to transition the economy is going to come from the private sector. So that would then naturally drive you to a view, which is to say we're going to have to look at innovative ways in which private money can invest in the public housing stock with local authorities and think about what that could look like. And I have no answers for that, Fiona, but I think what I'm saying is I think these issues need to be on the table and in a way which they've probably not been in the past, because I don't think that we're going to be able to address these issues unless we have those type of conversations. And I do go back to my point about inclusion, is that, you know, that there are across all economies, there's going to be a sizeable portion of people who will not be able to afford this transition. And we will need to think creatively about how we support those people, whether it's in housing, whether it's in transport or whatever, it's going to require support.
Thank you. And I'll pass back to the convener now.
Thanks very much. Fiona, Mark Ruskell is up next to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, I was just reflecting on some of the comments you're making about the convening power of the public sector, and I just wanted to sort of press you a bit on that. So, you know, specifically, you know, this inquiry is looking at local authorities. What's your sense of where local authorities can really drive that and crowd in that investment, really drive programs on the ground that can make those attractive propositions for investment in the low carbon space? So I'm particularly thinking around, you know, housing stock or you know, other investment opportunities where that works, and maybe where it perhaps doesn't work or where there isn't the capacity. So any brief comments you've got on that? And I suppose the other aspect of convening power is, you know, you're talking here about innovation in financial mechanisms. You know, it was interesting hearing about that Italian model. I know there are other sort of models around heat as a service and that can be developed as well. But to what extent do you see that as a role of government to effectively be bringing together energy companies and financial institutions to do that financial, you know, innovation? Or is that more the market needs to be leading on that and coming up with solutions that, you know, minimise the cost for homeowners and ensure that they can invest over a reasonable timescale rather than just getting a bill for £10,000 for something they can't afford? So I realise time's getting on, but if there's quick comments.
So just on that last question, I mean, I think it has to be both, because So I go back to my previous point, right? The reason why we're having to take policy steps to get on a net zero pathway, right, is because private sector mechanisms, they can't do it on their own, right? There is going to be different degrees of subsidy, loss absorption, however you want to, the financing gaps that exist. And so even if, so I think the challenge is, what's the private sector likely to be good at? Well, it is around innovation. It is about sort of turning the power of capitalism towards the challenge of decarbonisation, right? Financial innovation is something that the UK is very good at. However, any financial innovation, if it is not self-financing, right, because there is likely to be some financing gap because of the nature of the climate problem, that's where the participation of the public sector becomes absolutely sort of critical in the co-design of those mechanisms. The discussion about how much of that implicit financing gap or that catalyzation has to be absorbed by the public sector. How does the public sector ensure that it gets value for money, right, in that work? Because again, what it doesn't want to do is effectively sort of provide subsidy for risk-taking activity that ultimately doesn't have a social payoff, but does line the pockets of people who, you know, who do provide that finance. So there's all sorts of regulatory sort of and loss absorption mechanisms that I think are at play. And so this is why I think the partnership model is the best one, and having sort of task forces that can look in granular detail of what the potential options are, what works. You know, what about, for example, the US municipal sort of financing model works, which can be useful. But again, if you're talking about sort of bringing private sector capital in, right, you know, that's not just a matter of sort of issuing municipal bonds, and then sort of pooling that and making sort of decisions about how to make it, you know, advance it forward.
Yeah, thanks.
I think I would. Mark, I think on your first point, I think that there almost needs to be a layering of how government works, which I think that at times I think we've struggled a little bit. I think there needs to be a collective view across local authorities, as we talked about earlier, and maybe the city deal type model looks at it. But also, individual local authorities need to own that delivery. But in terms of packaging the scale, the opportunity together, actually, I think that we should do need to look at a more macro approach, but then delivery, I think, is going to be absolutely on the ground in that local authority. And I think one thing I would add as well, given in addition to SFE, I did the work on the Young Persons Guarantee. One of the things that highlighted there, which I do think government and local authorities have a key role in, is to make sure that we have the skills that will be able to execute the projects. If let's assume the funding model is made to work and it's there, then, you know, do we actually have the skilled labour in order to do, for example, the home insulation that's going to be needed at scale and at pace over the course of the next, eight years or so? And, you know, during the work I did, it was clear that we have a shortfall in that space. So actually, how do we make sure that we can partner up the funding with the partnership, with the skills, in order to make that combination work effectively?
Thanks. And Tim, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, just briefly on both your questions. So I think you're right to question kind of what does convening power mean? So to me, it means principally two things. The first is around the issue we've talked around packaging and scale, and that local authorities and local actors more broadly are well placed in many sectors to kind of bring together those in a way that the institutional investors can more comfortably get behind. The second is around funding and de-risking, which doesn't mean, I think it's absolutely right that the private sector needs to provide the vast majority of what is going to be a very capital intensive transformation. But in many areas, they don't need public sector funding to do that because the investment frameworks are already well developed. But where they're less well developed and where we do need innovation and where we are looking to deliver rapid change, I think that convening power can be brought with unlimited funding as well. I think on your question about the relationship around kind of innovation and markets and so on, the key thing for me is it's both, in the sense that you have to design the market to incentivize the kind of innovation that you want. And there's a kind of cliche, we used to have a liberalized energy market and now we don't. Well, the liberalized energy market, kind of, but to Jeremy's point earlier, we had this enormous externality in terms of CO2 emissions, which is hugely market distorting. And that's why you end up with the position that we found ourselves in 10 years ago. We've tried to internalize that in some ways, I would say, you know, reasonably successfully, but certainly imperfectly in the power sector. The question now is we have to learn the lessons from that in terms of designing markets which will deliver the kinds of investments that you want and that will de-risk those investments where it's appropriate. When we look at why is offshore wind got cheaper? Because the renewables obligation put a lot of risk on investors. The CFD puts less risk on investors. That isn't to say that we should completely de-risk investment, and it's right that investors take some risk, but we need to do that in a way that delivers a positive outcome for consumers and that enables the investment to come forward at the pace that we need.
Okay, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Great. Thanks very much, Mark. Let me pass to Liam Kerr for the final question of the session. Liam, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. I will just ask one question for time. I'll direct it to Tim Lord for reasons that will become apparent, and then Jeremy and Sandy, if you want to add to his answer, if you can indicate in the chat box, please. Tim Lord, the Deputy Convener's question about investing, I think, was a good one, and the answer that you gave about pensions and public influence, I think, will be important. You said one of the roles of pension funds was genuine emissions reduction and also talked about the energy market just in your last answer there. But of course, one of the ways to achieve that reduction is to increase our sourcing of local rather than imported oil and gas, which of course also helps reduce energy costs to the consumer and increases our energy security. And of course, we're in a context where the likes of BP and Shell are investing a great deal in EV charging. Other oil and gas companies are investing in wind power, which you've just talked about. So the question is, how do you, in terms of investment decisions, decide what is green and thus which companies or projects are appropriate to invest or disinvest in? And how much are those decisions influenced by, for example, the attitude and understanding of governments and the public to, in this case, the domestic oil and gas industry?
That's a great question, and we could talk for a very long time on this. And clearly, there's a range of factors that you know any investor takes into account when thinking about longer-term strategy. I think the key thing for us is that there's a very strong divestment movement from oil and gas, as you'll be very well aware of. What we're keen to do is work with a lot of the companies that we're invested with, because we need stable long-term returns. We also know that. While I think there is a place for divestment and that movement has been very powerful in some regards, it's also important that the oil and gas sector, for example, has many of the skills that we're going to need in order to deliver this transition in terms of the kind of big scale infrastructure that we want to see. So I think it's encouraging, exactly as you say, to see the diversification of some of the UK-based oil and gas majors in particular into renewables, and you've seen that elsewhere with Dong and Ørsted Energy in Denmark, who've completely transformed their business model, delivered a lot of value, and now is essentially a renewables company. And that's the kind of transition that we want to see. Clearly, when we're taking investment decisions for the longer term, we're taking account of kind of broader, political developments, policy developments, political risk, and so on. But I think that the key thing for us is what we want to do is work with the companies that we're invested in to look at what their transition plans look like. Are they sufficiently ambitious? That doesn't mean they need to turn on a dime in the next 6 months, but it does mean that they need to have a clear pathway to how they're getting to net zero themselves, with ambitious interim milestones, ideally based on science-based targets, as the Phoenix Group's target is, in order to decarbonize the portfolio. But in decarbonizing our portfolio, helping to drive the wider decarbonization of the economy, not just shift those emissions elsewhere.
I'm very grateful. Jeremy Lawson, do you wish to come in on this?
Yeah, I do. I mean, this is actually absolutely fundamental to our approach to investing around the energy transition. So a lot of the work that I've been doing within Aberdeen has been building out a scenario analytical framework that allows us to look at different technology and policy sort of pathways, and then sort of consider how that sort of affects the fair long-term valuation of different sort of companies that will be sort of influenced by that energy transition, but also have the potential to influence the energy transition itself through their own actions. So when we build these frameworks out, we're focused on a few things, but absolutely fundamental to it is what I would call credibility, right? So there are many countries have net zero objectives, but when you go underneath the bonnet of that, of those objectives, you'll find that there's very little substance to support any confidence that those objectives are going to be met on the timeframes that have been set out. Again, I'll use the example of Australia, right, which made a net zero 2050 commitment at the COP26 meetings, but made no new policy announcements at all, and suggested that they wouldn't do anything new between now and 2030, right? And so we would sort of mark that down as having low credibility, and we build that into account when sort of trying to therefore understand how companies within that jurisdiction are likely to behave, because the policy environment pins down what the companies in aggregate are likely to do. But that same credibility principle is just as important when thinking about individual corporations. As you're probably aware, there are a variety of initiatives that exist where either individual companies set their objectives, many sign on to, for example, science-based targets, although they're much more common in low fossil fuel intensive sectors than they are in the more fossil fuel intensive sectors. So we spend a lot of time thinking about the transition strategies of individual companies, right? Because the energy transition will not happen if currently brown companies don't become green, but not all brown companies will successfully become green. And you need research and analytical mechanisms to decide on that, because that'll have a sort of a crucial bearing on where the risks and opportunities around investing occur. So that's what we spend a lot of time sort of doing. And it's the intersection, both at that corporate level and at that policy level, that shapes our investment sort of processes and how we sort of then ultimately allocate capital around these sort of questions. And one other point is, and this is very important, it's about technology pathways. So in companies, in countries with large fossil fuel sectors, there is naturally a lot of focus on carbon capture and storage, right? Because it seems to offer a mechanism through which these industries may have long-term viable futures, even along an aggressive decarbonization pathway. However, where countries have to be careful is that the future of those technologies and their relative price compared with other, low carbon or zero carbon technologies is highly uncertain. Now, I wouldn't at all want to give the impression that carbon capture and storage may not be viable at scale in the future, but it is a sector that's had its sort of fair share of challenges over recent decades. Part of that's for public policy reasons, but from a policy perspective, just always be wary of locking yourself in to technology pathways that are themselves uncertain. Good policy, I think, sort of recognizes that there are many different ways that you might get to your endpoint, and that by keeping those options open and creating the right incentives, you're more likely to get to that pathway at low cost than if you lock yourself into something, it may turn out not to be the best way to solve it.
Understand. Thank you very much. Back to you, Convener.
Pleasure.
Great, Liam. Thanks very much. That brings us to the end of the questions and to the end of our allocated time. So let me thank Sandy, Jeremy and Tim. Thank you very much for taking part at the committee session this morning, for sharing your expertise and your insights across a number of very important areas. Enjoy the rest of your day. It's very much appreciated. And with that, I now close the public part of this meeting. Thank you.